G'day mate, Luke Ford here, and I've got a new guest on the show. I've got Erica here to talk about a new book that she suggested to me, which I just read this week, The Power of Habit, Why We Do What We Do in Life and Business. So during this time of the pandemic, a lot of people's habits are getting destroyed. the normal routines that we operate by have been disrupted. Any thoughts on disruption, pandemic, and restoring the power of habit, Erica?
Yes. Well, I think it's really important. Nice, healthy morning.
Whoa, Sorry, I was just losing you. Okay, we're back. Go ahead. Oh, okay. You can start again.
Having a good morning routine really makes or breaks how the rest of your day is going to be. So for me, I got this information from a book called The Miracle Morning by Hal Elrod, and basically suggests having six lifesavers in your life. And each letter of savers stands for a different action that you do. So the challenge that he gives you, wake up an hour before you usually wake up, hour for a different 10 minutes of six activities so that it equals out an hour. And the first thing is that for S is silence. So depending on your religion or your beliefs, you either spend this time meditating or you could spend this time. A stands for affirmation. So say these positive affirmations. So like, I'm healthy, I'm happy, I'm beautiful, whatever, or something that's really tailored to your. I'm an Amazon bestseller. You know, I have lost this amount of pounds and I've reached my goal already, and you act as if you already have gotten or achieved that goal. E stands for visualization. Vision boards come in, so even if you don't have a vision board, you could just have your eyes and engage. I'm the person you want.
Okay, sorry, your sound's fading in and out a little bit. I wonder if perhaps you need to be closer to your cam or something. But okay. Yeah, okay. So let's keep going. Let's see how we do.
Okay, should I start over?
Or just No. That's much better. That is much better for as far as sound quality. Okay. So just start wherever you want.
Okay. Yeah, I scooted closer to my webcam. Okay. So. Yes, the third thing is V for visualization, and even if you don't have a vision board, you just close your eyes, you engage in all five senses, and you see yourself either being the person you want to be or achieving the goal that you've always wanted to achieve. Once again, similar to the affirmations, acting as if you already have it done, and it's already in your life, and it's already a part of your identity and who you are. And then E stands for exercise, so you know, just maybe jump roping or doing some yoga, something to get the blood flowing. R is reading. So for 10 minutes, read a bit of a book that is, you know, of interest to you. And then S stands for scribing, which is taking out a journal and just, you know, kind of free writing for 10 minutes. Anything that's on your mind, any worries, maybe making a gratitude list, or things that you want to see done in that given day, and like how you can make your day amazing. And I think just by being consistent with this habit alone, it serves as a keystone habit, which is what Charles Duhigg discusses in the book. And keystone habits are basically habits that spill over into the rest of your life that make other things in your life easier to do, easier to accomplish, and even makes it easier to tackle other bad habits. So it's like the mega habit that will make other habits easier to tackle and just make yourself a more productive individual. And so I really think this is especially important during this time, because a lot of people, especially my age in particular, they think that, you know, this is just a time of boredom where they're just sitting on their phones, watching Netflix shows, just being lazy and like not really having an excuse to be productive because there's nobody holding them accountable. They don't have to punch a clock, and it's hard to have that discipline waking up voluntarily. But if you spend that time doing things for yourself, then it's going to make it a lot easier and make more productive, because if you already completed those six things in an hour, you're just going to want to do more things that are beneficial. So that's my insight on this pandemic and how a good morning routine, habit of it, will really get people out of fear and get out of this mindset of unproductivity.
Okay, and how long have you been doing this particular morning routine?
I have been really adamant about it for, a little over 2 months. Or I would only implement a few of the things. And that's the thing about it, is that you don't have to do it by the book. This is kind of like the order that he recommends, but there is a Miracle Morning community on Facebook, and a lot of people just tailor it best for them. They either spend more time on the journaling aspect as opposed to the exercising aspect, or maybe kind of do it three of those things later in the day instead of doing them all in the morning. So it really depends on what fits your needs and what your goals are, basically. But yeah, I mean, this really has helped me like appreciate life in the little moments. It's made me worried and anxious, because a huge part of it is from the meditation aspect of it, the silence part. I choose to meditate. And yeah, it just has made me more productive and better individual overall.
And what have been the primary challenges that you're facing in dealing with this shelter at home edict, essentially? A lot of people are going out of their minds. And for me, I stopped setting my alarm clock in the mornings. So I started getting off track. I'd get up in the mornings instead of this very disciplined routine that I was in prior to the shelter at home edict. I would immediately start checking the news. And so I would start getting off track, and I'd justify it by, well, I'm just staying at home. I don't have all these things I need to accomplish. How about for you? What have been the primary challenges?
Yeah, I mean, probably I think dragging out the morning routine, because I know that I don't have to be anywhere. Yeah, so I am only human, so I do tend to fall into that trap of, especially in this time where usually I would be really on top of it. If I had to go to school, I would like wake up at 5, because I would have to be at school at 8, and I knew that, okay, well, if I have to be there at a certain time, then I need to get up at 5. But now that I know that I'm only going to be home for the rest of the day, and for, you know, this extended period of quarantine that we're in, it is kind of hard to have the willpower and the discipline to really like stay focused disciplined in this routine sometimes, because I'll wake up late and I'll do it. But then I notice that the reward isn't the same. So that's kind of what this book goes into too. Noticing your like triggers and you know, seeing how you react to that. So if your cue is waking up, and instead of in the alarm clock, and your routine now is watching the news instead of doing something else that was productive, and the reward is maybe you're feeling bad about yourself for not, you know, doing what you were supposed to be doing in that routine time, then I really recommend just getting out a piece of paper and writing this down. Okay, like when I woke up, you know, the cue was the alarm clock. Okay, what was I feeling during this time? You know, maybe I was alone. It's this exact time in the morning. I'm, you know, feeling this way. Like any emotions that come into mind, just jot it down and just kind of become your own little experimenter, because then you'll notice, okay, well, what kind of route, maybe the reward that you get from watching the news is that you feel connected with the world because you are up to date. I mean, I can't speak for you. I'm assuming. Mm-hmm. Is that why?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. You're like, you're feeling up to date. You're feeling connected, and you feel like, okay, like you're doing your civic duty, so to speak, because you're aware of what's going on. And I mean, you can't really, no one can blame you, because everyone feels that need to watch the news. Because, you know, they want to feel safe and secure, and they want to know any updates. So then kind of like seeing, taking that routine out, watching the news, and being like, okay, well, if the reward that I get is safety, security, and comfort, what routine can replace that will still give me that same reward? And this is where you, you know, like I said, you experiment, you try different routines. For me, I mean, I always think that the mega ultra routine is meditating, because that, and not only gives me happiness and a sense of euphoria, but also gives me calmness. It eases my anxiety. Because I think a lot of the misconception with the news is that people do it because they want to feel secure and comforted and knowing, you know, what's going on, but really it can instill a lot of fear. And the media tends to do that. They only focus on the negative of what's going on. It's very little the positive. I mean, we don't really hear of like who's been cured of the coronavirus. It's just more of like, okay, more and more cases of people who are getting infected by it. And this could be really detrimental to our mental health, because, you know, it puts us in this fear state of like things are only getting worse instead of better. And it primes us to look at the negatives instead of the positives. So I tend to kind of divert away from that. And if I do want to keep up with the news, it's with a newspaper, because there's less stimuli coming at you, because with the news, they have, you know, their facial expressions, and then you see the visual imagery of how people are affected, and it could really get to you negatively. So I think reading words on a paper, you have less of that like sadness effect being put on you, but you're still kind of keeping up to date. So maybe that's a different routine that you should try, or, you know, meditating. I don't know. You really have to be the one to experiment for yourself and see what works for you.
Yeah, I had this very disciplined program prior to this pandemic, where my alarm would go off at 5:32 a.m. Then I'd get in a cold shower, and then I'd take certain supplements. I would do my prayers. I'd do meditation. I'd get on a 12-step phone meeting. I'd talk to my sponsees. I'd do exercises, and up until about 8 a.m. when I'd usually start working. So the first 2.5 hours of my day were very scheduled with all sorts of healthy activities for both body, mind, and soul. And so I've gone back to setting my alarm to 5:32 a.m. That's helped me getting back to that routine. I absolutely avoid TV and TV news. So I read the LA Times, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal to stay informed. But I've been able to get back to my regular routine, and that's helped a lot, because I one thing I loved in this book is it points out that about 40% of what we do is just habit, and so we don't think about it. And so because I've got this particularly disciplined routine for starting the day, I normally don't have to think about it, and just one thing leads to another. The cold shower is the most difficult part of my day, which I just get done by 5:35 a.m. So I've already accomplished the most challenging part of my day. And so I find it really helpful to have a routine. I really need routine. I really need good habits, like stacking small wins on top of each other. Because when I have to make decisions all the time, or should I work out, or should I pray now, making decisions is so tiring that I kind of run out of willpower if I don't rely on my habits. So I don't know if you have any thoughts related to any of that.
Oh, yes, I really agree. It does become tiring. And then more often than not, if you end up listening to devil on your shoulder instead of the angel, because the brain it really likes to be comfortable, and it doesn't like to be happy. So even though, you know, you're supposed to be working out, or you're supposed to be doing this and that, it's like, okay, well, let me be lazy instead, because it likes that instant gratification. That's what's comfortable, not really looking out for what's going to make you happy. So you really do need to be on top of it and stay disciplined, and always, you know, affirm to yourself and know, okay, well, I know that if I do this in the long run, after I do it, I'm not going to be happy if I like lazily like scroll through social media, my phone, you know, feed other people's ego with likes and whatever, and, you know, start feeling sorry for myself and start, you know, being fearful of the world around me because of this pandemic. Know that, okay, last time I did this, like I took a mental note, and I know that the reward wasn't cost of just having that instant gratification of delaying my responsibility. Yes, it's really good to stay on top of your routine and have self-discipline. And I think just taking note of, okay, and reminding yourself of, okay, last time I know that this action led to this, you know, negative feeling inside of me, like of being unproductive and lazy, or just not being fulfilled as I should have been that day. So I know to prevent that. And you're just really, you know, conscious effort of it so that, you know, that little devil on your shoulder gets eaten, so to speak.
Yeah, I lost much of my 20s. I had chronic fatigue syndrome and I was basically bedridden. And then finally, about age 27, I managed to make about 2/3 of a recovery. But ever since getting ill, I find change very exhausting. I do much better when I have a routine, when I go from A to B to C and it's all set and it's all a habit. And encountering like new things and change and unfamiliar environments is very, very tiring. So that's why for me, having habits are just so important. Having a routine is just so important, particularly if it's a routine that serves me. Because when we have to make decisions, it just starts to just tire you out. And I notice that our willpower goes down as the day goes along. So I have more willpower at 6 a.m. than I do at 1 p.m. I have more willpower at 1 p.m. than I do at 7 p.m. I have more willpower at 7 p.m. than midnight. And so therefore, I try to accomplish the most important parts of my day first. So normally, I don't look at the news or I don't look at social media for about 3 hours after I get up, because I want to get into good spiritual shape. I want to get into good physical shape. I want to be centered and balanced and ready to tackle the most important parts of my day before I get distracted with the news. And then I strongly rely on routine throughout my day. I know what I'm doing at 8 a.m., 10 a.m., 2 p.m., 3 p.m., 4 p.m., 7 p.m., and that just kind of streamlines my decision making so that I have mental power and willpower to deal with important decisions that come up, and I haven't just dissipated my mental resources on things that are less important. Don't know if you have any thoughts. Do you have a set routine typically?
Yes. So when I wake up, it's probably around, I try to do 5, which is what he recommends. It, for me personally, that was a little bit too early. Not too early, but not too late. And I have this like motivation.
I'm losing your audio again. I don't know if you could maybe speak
up.
Yeah. Or come back. Yeah. Yeah. So go ahead and speak up.
Okay. Yeah, so I wake up around 6, and that's when I set my alarm. And I have 2 alarms because sometimes, yeah, I do, depending on how late I ended up falling asleep the night before, I have another one set so that it reminds me, okay, around like 6:15, 6:30 max. So this is, yeah. So I get up, and I have this motivational clock. It's this app in the App Store, and cost money, but it's only like $5 or maybe even less. But like this person who kind of gives you like this motivational speaking, so you wake up to that instead of this like annoying ring. And I think that is way better, because then it's like it's somebody telling you these positive things instead of you hearing this annoying sound. And I think that's the main reason why people go back to bed and fall asleep and not wake up, because they're not being woken up to something positive. So I have this motivational alarm clock, and this woman just, you know, tells me positive things. So that gives me the willpower to get up out of my bed and hear it. And I also apply the Mel Robbins 5-second rule, where she says anything you do, just, you know, count down in your head 5, 4. In 5 seconds, make that decision, either get up or stay in bed. And since you know the reward for getting up is going to outweigh the reward that you have for staying in bed, because then you feel sorry for yourself, you end up getting up. So I get up, and I do the lifesaver. So I first meditate for a bit, and I make sure that I go outside into my living room. My bed, I know I'm just going to fall back asleep. So knowing this, I go in my living room, meditate for a bit, or I put on a jacket and I force myself to go out. Better meditation if I am surrounded by trees, grass, and smelling the fresh air. I do a guided meditation because I find it better than just kind of concentrating on my breath personally. Really big on doing guided meditations, and he actually has his own guided meditations that he's made. So him. And this will last, I make mine last around 30 minutes because I do like a 10-minute one that's more religious. I mean, I don't consider myself Catholic, but I do believe in God. So I'm kind of working on my relationship with God. It's just a personal decision I decided to make. So I listen to a 10-minute meditation centered more around Christianity. And then I listen to his meditation, Karen Dowdy, the YouTubers. And after that, depending on whether I went outside or not, I go back into my room. I read the affirmations. How Elrod provides affirmations for self-confidence, for financial success, for family-related goals, and for like leisure time stuff. So I read his affirmations. And then I go into visualization. I have my own vision board. I just engage in all my senses, see what I want.
And then what about as your day goes along? Do you typically have a highly scheduled day, or are you more spontaneous?
I am somewhat spontaneous, but I do tend to stick to three things out of the day, because in my process of my miracle morning, I have this 5-minute journal, and it asks you what are three things that you can do that can make. I make sure that I stick to those three. After that, like anything else really goes, because I feel like setting too many goals in a ends up backfiring, because I found personally that I can't up to those goals, that set it too high, and then it ends up making me feel bad about myself because, oh, I didn't complete these goals, blah, blah, blah. So it's just three. Sometimes it's big, like, oh, I want to read 5 chapters of this book I'm reading, or maybe it's smaller, like, oh, I want to make sure that I call my grandma today and see how she's small scale to large scale. But typically, since I am a student, I mean, my days are more not, so I make sure that for me to stay sane during this time of quarantine, specifically, I higher goals that are more challenging because I have more time on my hands rather than like little ones, like I would do when I have to go to school or have to go to work and punch a clock, just because I have more time. So I like to challenge myself.
One thing I noticed in the book is it talked a lot about the power of God, that you can do all sorts of, you know, changing of habits and redirecting things. But a lot of people, they only overcome, say, alcoholism or drug addiction or something with the power of God. It's the power of something greater than yourself. And I can really relate to that because, for example, I used to get fired all the time for inappropriate speech because I really enjoy saying shocking things. I come from Australia, and we use the expression taking the mickey out of someone. It's like you wind them up and you provoke them, and it's just kind of a national sport in Australia. And it's a national sport also in England. It's not so much the dumb thing in the United States. But I would always enjoy provoking people. And so I'd just constantly get into trouble in the workplace, and I was constantly getting fired. And I would try to overcome it by saying, okay, today I'm just going to be well-behaved. I'm not going to try to troll anyone. I'm not going to try to provoke anyone. I'm just going to be the perfect gentleman. And that didn't work. But when I got into some 12-step programs for various emotional addictions that I had, I was able to change my mindset to today I want to be of service to God, and I want to help God's kids, and how can I be of service to my employer, or how can I be of service to my clients, how can I be a blessing to the people around me. And by putting God first, then all my habitual problems that were destroying me in the workplace, they just all went away. And I didn't even have to tackle those problems directly. I didn't have to hold myself back from stirring people up and provoking people and trolling people. Instead, if I just put in my mind that I'm here to be of service to God's kids, then all my habitual problems just kind of disappeared. And whenever I got out of that mindset of being of service to God's kids, my habitual problems would come roaring back. Do you have any thoughts?
Yes, I can relate to this. I mean, before I decided to go the religious route and accept God, I'm kind of more into the new age, I found that, you know, it's very similar. Instead of, you know, saying God as your higher power, body is centered about your higher self being something that you aim. So I kind of have now, through my experiences, combined God and my higher self. Yeah, that has helped me a lot in showing up for myself and making healthier, better decisions that add value to myself. As meditations, when I part of the guided part of it is kind of like envisioning yourself, you know, with your higher self. What does she look like? How does she respond to people? How does she set boundaries and whatever? And so you have that by doing that habitually every day in your routine, then you could always draw back on that meditative experience and be, oh, okay, like I remember how good it felt by engaging in these. My quote unquote higher self doing the things that I want to do. And so I should act in accordance to that because I remember of how good it feels. So yeah, it is a very similar testimony. But yeah, I think it's always good to side of yourself to something higher than you, whether that be God or your higher self, whatever you believe in. Grounded, knowing that you're acting in service to others and knowing that you have it all figured out, you know, and that you're you have this moral guideline to follow.
Right. Another thing that I got out of the book is the importance of belonging to a group, particularly if it's some kind of serious emotional addiction that you or substance addiction that you want to overcome. I've never dabbled in alcohol or drugs, so I don't know about that. But I do know that I had this girlfriend who told me one day that she was a love addict, and I'd never heard of, you know, love addiction. I had this like very tumultuous relationship with her, and she said she was a love addict. So this is how I go through life. I was like, oh wow, that's interesting. So I went to the library and I checked out like 5 books on love addiction. Like I read up on love addiction, and then I go, oh wow, I'm a love addict too, and this is fascinating. But I didn't do anything about it. I just talked about it a little bit in therapy and then just continued on with my life. And then finally, about a few years later, I finally decided to do something about it. And I went to my first 12-step program for problems like love addiction and relationship addictions. And just stepping into that room, it was this like kind of grungy, dingy room in Culver City. And, you know, I kind of looked around and looked like a bunch of losers. And I was kind of thinking, my God, what am I doing here? And then when people started to share about their problems in the field of sex and love, and some people it's, you know, codependency, and for other people it's porn or whatever it is, I was able to relate to something that almost everybody said as the room went around and shared. And I suddenly sensed that I am home. And I felt a calm that I had not felt in many years, and a sense of emotional sobriety as well that started to kind of ripple out in my life. And I thought, oh wow, I want more of this. And I started going back day after day, and being part of a group and having these regular meetings and making friends and seeing people's lives transform and seeing people recover and getting married and having kids and starting their own businesses. And that gave me just tremendous hope and inspiration that inspired me to make all sorts of changes that I hadn't been doing just on my own or even via therapy. But belonging to a group was essential to my recovering some level of emotional sobriety.
Yes, I think the group dynamic is very important, but it also doesn't have to be like a physical group too. I mentioned earlier that I'm part, because of I read The Miracle Morning by Hal Elrod, there's a Facebook group for that, and people really encourage each other, and they share their testimonies of how it's transformed their lives, and you can post on there too if you have any concerns, and people reach out with, you know, their own lived experiences and how maybe they had the same concern that you've had or the same trouble in following through with it and how they overcame it. So that sense of community really does keep you accountable. And he even recommends, the author, Hal Elrod, having an accountability partner. And if you don't have anybody in your life, then going on that Facebook group and joining it and finding someone, even posting, hey, I need somebody who's going to text me at 6 a.m. when my alarm comes off, or, you know, making sure that I followed through with the Miracle Morning and I did everything that I said I was going to do. So I do think that sense of community is important, whether that's virtual or in person. And I know that for me personally, with marijuana addiction, I used to be addicted to marijuana. I would smoke weed 7 days a week, 3 times a day. I knew that meditation would be the proper routine to combat smoking, right? Because I would see firsthand from these YouTubers when I would go on YouTube and how they combated weed by replacing smoking with meditation. And they all said, you know, it offers the same thing, relaxation, calmness, the sense of serenity and tranquility and joy, and like this, you know, all these positive emotions, all these things that a lot of marijuana addicts, they seek to get out of weed. And this one YouTuber in particular, Aaron Dowdy, who I've been referencing a lot because I really like him and he inspires me, but he shared his testimony about how he started meditating instead of smoking and how it offered the same benefits and how he had the discipline to resist the temptation when he was around people to smoke, to just kind of meditate instead. And I thought, you know what, let me apply that routine too. And so sure enough, it worked for me personally, and it's something that I start advocating now too. And what I love about meditating is that you can do it anytime, anywhere. So even if you are choosing to still be friends with people who are part of those habits that were bad to you, like smoking or, you know, drinking or whatever, even if you don't want to cut them out of your life because maybe, you know, you love them and you still want to be friends with them and you still want to have that relationship with them. For me, meditating was just that one thing. While they were smoking, I could just close my eyes. I didn't have to, you know, have a certain object or whatever. I just had to be there with myself and just, and know that, okay, while they're smoking, I can do this. So that sense of community is really good. And yeah, I just wanted to add that. And it doesn't have to be physical. It could also be virtual through YouTube and just through like Facebook groups.
And what is your experience with community in general? So community has been a big part of my life. I grew up in a very strict religious community. My father was a preacher, and I grew up a Seventh-day Adventist. Then I became an atheist for a few years. I went out into the world, and then I came back, and I converted to Orthodox Judaism. So for most of my life, community has been essential. But I noticed that half the people I meet feel very uncomfortable in community. They find it's stifling. They feel like people are, you know, interfering in that they know too much about them. They don't like living in community. So what is your experience with community?
I mean, I guess I could see where a lot of people are coming from because it can be overwhelming and it can be intimidating. And a lot of people, they feel uncomfortable with going outside of their shell and going outside of their comfort zone and they can kind of feel embarrassed. Admitting that they have a problem or talking about their problems in just like that physical setting. So yes, for me personally, I found that online communities are less, it's less overbearing and it's, you know, it's more comfortable because you can go in anytime, anywhere, and it's in the comfort of your home. No one has to know about it. You don't have to tell anyone because you just have to have your laptop. So I find, you know, online communities work for me personally. But yeah, I mean, it's really just about seeing what you like. And yeah, I mean, I've had my own little community, mainly in schools. I was part of Toastmasters Club in college, and I'm still part of it, but now it's online. And I'm part of, what else am I part of? Oh yeah, I'm part of this vegan society that has, you know, because of the coronavirus, we don't meet anymore. But yeah, I think that even outside of your addiction, just kind of like being part of community of people that have the same passion and values that you do. And, you know, yeah, and just kind of like growing together. And you never know, because in that Toastmasters meetings that I would have, I would find people who were like me, who, you know, they were addicted to marijuana and stuff too, and they made speeches about it. And you never know who you're going to find. So, you know, just kind of, I encourage people to put themselves out there, but if they're too reluctant to, then start online first. I think online communities are the best for people who are too scared to kind of step out of their shell and maybe don't want to make that step yet.
And did you come from a strong religious community growing up? Did you have experience with that?
Yes, I was raised Catholic, so I had my first community, but I didn't ever go through confirmation. But I kind of fell into the path of doing what a lot of people do, my age in particular, where I really let outside influences and people kind of influence what I was raised with. And so I had my, you know, church group, and this lasted for like 5 years. I mean, up until I was probably around 9 or 10 years old, I would go to this church group, and we would meet up and we would talk about God and whatnot. But then I went to high school, and in high school, I had a lot of atheist friends. Some were agnostic, and some a majority of them were atheist, and they would talk bad about God and say how a lot of atheists would say, like, oh, you know, how can you believe in something that doesn't exist and everything? And because during that age, you really want your social inclusion needs to be met, I fell into the trap of rejecting my spirituality and my relationship with God just to fit in. And so I would engage in that kind of rhetoric that they would and conform to their beliefs just so I could get approval and just so I could fit in with them, because I didn't want to lose them as friends. And, you know, I was like, I was willing to people please at the expense of my own beliefs and what I knew was my truth. So that is kind of an example of how community can be a bad thing. If you're young and you want to fit in and you, you know, you feel the need to reject what you know is true just to fit in. But yeah, I was able to get outside of that. And once I went to college and I figured out, okay, you know, people are a lot more accepting. They're a lot more mature. We've kind of grown out of that phase. And I met people who, and like club, I was part of clubs too, that where we respected everyone's individual differences in terms of spirituality. And I learned to kind of be more tolerant and respectful and just kind of stick up for myself too, of what I believed. And yeah, I started delving into different religions and kind of like taking a piece of everything. Because yeah, I mean, I noticed an unconscious behavior within myself, is that, okay, I tend to have this need to people please and have these codependent traits inside of me where I get validation from other people. And I really, once I got to college, I rejected that. I was like, you know what, this isn't making me happy. It's not making me the person I want to be. Like, I see these people who stick up for themselves, who are unapologetically themselves and how confident they are. I want to be like that too. And so, yeah, I've kind of adopted some new age beliefs, which is like meditating, affirmations and whatever, while also blending in still Christian beliefs, and Catholicism, and making my own sense of what I believe is true based on my truth. So yeah, that's kind of my insight on that.
At what age did you begin using marijuana?
I started smoking, gosh, let's see, Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It was my junior year. So I was like 17 or 16, my junior year of high school. But at that point, it wasn't a habit. I would say it became a habit when I went to community college, because a big trigger, part of the habit loop, which is what Charles Duhigg talks about in the book, is triggers, right? The cue. That's the first part. It's cue, routine, reward. And so the cue for me was boredom, because it became a habit when I was in community college, because I was so bored. All of my friends, they moved away. They moved out of the state into different colleges. And my close knit of people, the people who I associated my identity with, my core sense of self and who I was, they were all gone. And so I really didn't know who I was. And a part of that was always people pleasing them and like conforming to who they were. And so once they were gone, I was like, oh, you know, I have nothing to make me happy, nothing to make me feel like secure and safe. And I would be just so bored out of my mind. I would always complete my homework well before it was due. And that's when I got into smoking, because I started to hang out with some people, and I wouldn't say they were part of the wrong crowd. I mean, you know, everyone's entitled to do what they want to do. They are entitled to live their own lives, but they would smoke, and I was like, okay, well, I have no one else to hang out with, and you know, I want to have friends, so I'm gonna smoke too. And it just, yeah, it really became a habit. And that's the thing about habits. I mean, they slip out of our awareness because they can become so automatic. And but I was, you know, smoking 7 days a week, three times a day. And it got to the point where I was beginning to really be disgusted with myself. Because the thing about weed is that once you become a stoner and you're doing it all day, every day, you don't even really get high. I would call it more sedated, because unlike your first time, or you're, you know, doing it once in a while, it's not really the same experience. You don't have that like nice sense of euphoria and happiness that lasts for a long time. Instead, when you become a stoner, once you smoke and it hits your brain, that feeling of euphoria is like for only like a minute or so. And then after that, you start feeling just kind of like whatever. Like, yeah, you get like that body sensation and that head sensation, but it's not nearly as fun or good as it was when you were only doing it, you know, here and there, or when you first started doing it. But you still do it because it's a habit, and your brain's so used to that comfort and that pattern of smoking all the time that you just feel weird not doing it. And what really broke me out of that was just disgust. And after reading the book too, I was like, you know what? Now that I know that habits are formed from these neurological cravings, what am I actually craving? I knew it wasn't weed, because I knew that in order to be a happy, fulfilled individual, you can get everything inside of yourself. And I found that what I was actually craving was, you know, self-improvement and confidence and, you know, feeling whole and complete, because I would go to weed to escape my reality. I would go to weed for happiness and for euphoria. And I was like, okay, I need to change the routine of smoking to still get those same effects, but in a healthy way. And then, like I said previously, that's when I started meditating and researching about that and implementing that in my lifestyle. And then after reading this self-improvement book, I started reading other self-improvement books. And then I, you know, got into The Miracle Morning by Hal Elrod, read that book, and yeah, my life changed for the better since then. So
how long have you been sober from marijuana?
I've been sober for like 3 months, but I will say this, I'm not perfect. And now I still smoke, but only when I am out with my friends and if we're celebrating something, like if we're going to a bar or club, because I absolutely hate alcohol. But I will say that it took me a while to get to that point of me only limiting smoking to those types of activities, which is just, you know, going out and celebrating. Because I think it's important for people to have that time where they're completely isolated. And many people, they can't. Maybe alcoholics, you know, they can't have that relationship with alcohol where it's just for celebratory means, even after facing an addiction. For them, it's like that'll always be a trigger for them to go into the downward spiral of relapsing and like going back into those bad behaviors. But for me, because I kind of defeated my own inner demons through this morning routine that I have and like meditating, going within, I was able to have a lot that of a better relationship with weed. So now it's only once in a while that I do it. And because I'm not a big drinker, I hate drinking, but I do like to, you know, have some pleasure. And so I'll smoke and I'll do it when I'm out at a club or out at a bar. But that I want to say is probably like twice a month. But it did take a while for me to get to that point where I could limit myself to just that twice a month. So I really encourage people to, you know, really stay consistent with the habit loop of cue, routine, changing the routine so that it elicits the same reward and staying consistent with it. And just kind of like noticing within yourself, okay, am I like still able to have this routine when I relapse or am I not? And if you're not, then, you know, that's for you to figure out and that's for you to see, okay, maybe I shouldn't do just have it once in a while, but I'm able to do it because I worked through it and it's just me personally, but everyone's different. So, you know, to each their own.
Now, what effect did it have on your life when you were getting high three times a day?
Oh, I would be so lazy. So unproductive. Yeah, I wouldn't even have dreams because it messes with your REM sleep. So yeah, I would just, it also made me very socially awkward, but because I was a stoner, I didn't even care. And a lot of my friends were saying, oh, we miss the old Erica, blah, 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 because I would just not be all there. I wouldn't want to talk to people because I would be really high and I would just like overanalyze everything and get in my head of like, oh, people, like, they know I'm high, like, I have to act normal. But then in the effort of trying to be normal and trying to act normal, it just made me look even more weird and sus out of it. So, but because I was such a stoner, because I cared about that little slice of euphoria I would get and happiness I would get, I didn't care about, you know, get going and being social. Like, I would be in these social settings and I would smoke, and knowing that people thought that about me, it's like, it made me be very selfish. In other words, like, I would just be like, eh, whatever. Like I would be in my head and it would be discomforting knowing people were saying that, but that discomfort wasn't enough to outweigh my addiction because I would still want to smoke and be like, okay, who cares what they think? Like, I'm still going to smoke. I'm, you know, like, even if my friends are saying, oh, we miss York Erica, like, blah, 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 I want to still smoke. And that's the thing about an addiction. Like, it really takes over who you are as a person in your life and everything. And so, yeah, I just, what really made me change was that own disgust in myself. And that was after really like a long time of and getting to that place. But yeah, now, I mean, yeah, when, sorry. What were you...
when your friends said we miss the old Erica, so I have no personal experience with marijuana. I've never tried it, so I'm not really attuned to how it affects people. So when they say we miss the old Erica, how is the old Erica different from the stoned Erica?
I guess the old Erica was more present in the moment and able to listen and able to talk to people and have a conversation and not forget what was being said, because that was another thing. I knew that I would forget midway through a story I would tell or through a story somebody else was telling me, that I would forget what we were even talking about. And so that was another reason why I wanted to stay secluded and isolated from people in these settings. Not necessarily because I wanted to be rude and or anything, or, you know, I didn't want to get to know somebody or a stranger better, but mainly because I was just in my own head and knowing, okay, well, even though weed is making me do these things and making me kind of like forget and stuff like that, I still like the feeling that it gives me. I like feeling happy or whatever, being in my own little zone. Like, so I'm just not going to talk to people. I know this is going to happen. or whatever. So I think that came from them saying we miss the old Erica, the Erica that, you know, wanted to get to know people, wanted to talk, wanted to share stories, and was a good listener and, you know, provided good feedback, because I was definitely not that Erica when I was stoned. I was just out of it and kind of sedated and like not being able to retain anything that was being spoken to me about, or being able to offer any stories or stuff, because I would forget what I was talking about mid-sentence. So I really think that's what you meant.
How did it affect your grades and your perhaps your work and your hobbies or extracurricular activities?
You know, that's the weird thing about me is that I'm a very peculiar case, because I was a 4.0 GPA stoner. For some reason, school has always been ingrained in my head since I was little. And it was just always been a natural part of me to have a strong work ethic in school and do good in school. So I really was able to balance school life with my addiction. And some, you know, I would even sometimes do my work stoned and write my essays stoned. So I was able to still balance it, which is weird, because then people were like, okay, well then why would you want to change if you were able to balance it all? But it got to the point where I was just feeling disgusted with myself and just feeling very depressed and low, because, you know, like I was saying, that happiness and euphoria only lasts for a little bit once you're a stoner. And once it becomes a habit, it's like, oh, and you're doing it all the time. You don't even really get those heightened effects from it like other people do when they don't smoke as much. And because of that, it made me depressed. And that depression kind of made me really want to change and want to transform. So yeah, that's why I made the decision to transform and get out of it.
Interesting. And did you use a 12-step group to reduce the marijuana use, or did you do it through other methods?
No, I didn't do a 12-step group. I actually had an accountability partner, which is, she was a friend of mine, and she was also an addict, and she also wanted to change. And the weird thing about her is that she actually was one of my cues or my triggers, so to speak, because I associated her with smoking all the time. But she got to the point where she was kind of developing her sense of spirituality and wanting to be the highest version of herself and be a good person and stuff. And she wanted to quit like me. Once I said, I was like, once I was honest with her and said, I'm feeling really disgusted, you know, and I think our relationship has turned toxic, because even though, you know, we love each other and stuff as friends, every time we hang out, there's this unconscious belief that we have to smoke because we're together, since we're so used to only doing that activity whenever we hang out. So if we're really serious about quitting, then I think we need to distance ourselves, but keep each other accountable at a distance. So we kind of stopped hanging out with each other, just for the benefit of our own, each other's health. But during that time, we still reached out, and she would text me and be like, okay, did you smoke today or did you not? Blah, blah. So knowing that she was somebody that was going to text me or, you know, yell at me or call me out if I slipped up, made me more definite in sticking with being clean. And also, you know, with the meditations and all that stuff, that really helped. But yeah, having an accountability partner really was like the cherry on top with making sure that I followed through with this.
Did you have any adults, any professors, or any adults in your life who were concerned about the effect that getting stoned regularly was having on you?
Just mainly my mom, because she's from Mexico, and her brother suffers from drug addiction, and it started from weed. So because of that, she's very... she was kind of more concerned than my dad about weed. My dad, he grew up smoking. So it was a cultural difference. And because culturally, and she saw the firsthand effects of how weed was a gateway drug for her brother, I think that's why she was concerned when she would see me smoking and why she would be upset about that. But she also kind of really was the reason also that I wanted to change, because knowing that she would be upset and knowing that I was, kind of breaking her heart, I guess you could say. I didn't like that feeling, and I didn't like knowing that I was hurting her, and I didn't like knowing that I was being selfish by still wanting to smoke, even though I knew that she disapproved of it. So she kind of, in a way, was like an indirect effect of making me stop. She never said, you know, don't do that, blah blah blah, but I would be caught sometimes because I would smoke on my patio. And I remember one night she came out and she just like looked at me. She didn't even say anything. And then she went in, but she didn't even have to say anything. I just knew that she was disappointed. So I think that also reiterates the fact that, you know, you can tell somebody a bunch of times, don't do this, blah, 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 but they really have to have it within themselves to want to change so bad because they're so disgusted with their current state of being. And I think the more you tell somebody, oh, don't do this, blah, 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 I'm pointing your finger at them, then the more they're going to want to do it and the more they're going to want to rebel. So in a way, I'm kind of grateful that she never really directly said to me, okay, don't smoke, blah, 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 and look me in the eye and like pointed her finger, because then I would have probably rebelled more. But because, you know, she was silent and she just kind of gave me that look, and it did make me feel more bad. So she was a really big indirect effect of me wanting to change too.
And did it serve as a gateway drug for you?
Yes, it did. Yeah. But the thing is, I wasn't addicted to the other drugs that I would take. I would go out with my friend Nicole, and we would go out to the clubs in LA. And the LA scene is, it's kind of similar to Vegas, where there's a promoter and then he has the girls that he brings out with him, to a table, and basically everything is free. And there's a client there that he's trying to serve. And so the client likes attractive girls, and, the client would also have drugs, and everything would always be free. You know, the drinks would be free, like free bottle service, free entry into the club, free after party, free Ubers. So it's like free, free, free if you're an attractive girl. So, because we knew everything was free and because it was so easily accessible, we would, take the drugs sometimes. But for some reason, those drugs never had the same effect on me as weed. Like, I never felt the need to do them repetitively like I did with weed. I would do some cocaine and some ecstasy here and there, but I never felt like hooked on them like I did with weed. But you know, everyone's different, and that was just my story. But it definitely was smoking weed definitely did give me the confidence to not view those drugs as hard, quote unquote, like hard drugs, as like the media or like how you hear about. Because I was like, well, if I can drink and I can smoke, I guess cocaine wouldn't be bad. I guess, you know, ecstasy wouldn't be bad. Like, all these other girls are doing it and it's free, you know. And we like, and this was after like going out with the promoter for a few months too. So we had built trust with him, and we knew that they weren't gonna, you know, sell us and like we wouldn't be human trafficked or something. So, I was able to take those things here and there, but yeah, like I said, it didn't have the same dependency or like craving, that I got from weed. So I was able to keep my distance.
And what about the intoxicating effect that, you must have discovered that your beauty has on men? Do you have any reflections on that? Because if you simply go out to a club, you put a little bit of effort, or maybe you don't even need any effort whatsoever. You just get out there, you're young and you're hot, and you have an intoxicating effect on men. Do you have any reflections on that?
In terms of like being self-conscious, like thinking like the worst of them, if like they're gonna, you know, try to drug me and stuff?
No, let me rephrase. So I've had various gorgeous girlfriends, and for many of them, I would ask them how much of your self-esteem comes from your looks, and they frequently say 100%. So it's when you're young and you're hot, like a lot of things will come easy. You will have tremendous power over people without any reference to any character or skills or intelligence or anything else that you bring to the table. So it's easy for a lot of, you know, young, attractive women to not excel, say, in school, because everything comes so easy from being young and hot. How about you? Do you get a substantial amount of your self-esteem from your looks, or do you get it from your friendships or from your academic accomplishments or from where?
Yes. It wasn't until probably about 6 months ago that I realized that I do actually get a lot of my feeling of self-worth and whatnot from my looks, because 6 months ago I started getting bad acne, adult acne, and you know, once you have that on your face and it's like something you can't avoid, even though it affects a lot of people, like I always had clear skin and stuff. And so once I got that acne, I would look in the mirror and I would feel disgusted with myself, and really, it was really hard to think that I'm like beautiful and stuff like that, even though I was always told that I was an attractive person. That really kind of like shocked me and like kind of got me into talking negatively to myself, because it was like a big flaw that I saw and I couldn't get out of that story I would tell myself. And because it affected me so much, it got to the point where I didn't even want to go out because I had pimples on my face and I was subconscious of what other people would think about me. And I would create this narrative in my head that all they're looking at is my skin, even though that wasn't probably the truth. I was just making it the truth, because it was just reflective of my own insecurities. And once I got acne, I realized, you know what, I do put a lot of value on external beauty. And maybe that did come from all these years of me being rewarded for my beauty via free entry to clubs and, you know, free drinks and stuff like that. So now I'm still struggling with acne, and I'm really working on seeing it as a lesson and as an opportunity to, you know, redefine my values and know that, okay, if anybody does judge me on my skin, I know that they resonate at the shallow level, and why would I even want them in my life anyway? So kind of having that perspective has helped, and doing more meditations that are focused on skin in general and saying affirmations related to skin has helped too. But yes, I used to think, you know, I don't really, you know, value the external beauty as much as others. Like, I get my sense of completeness and worthiness from my schoolwork, since I've always been a good student. But yeah, it wasn't until I got the acne, I was like, oh wait, actually, I do care a lot about what I look like and care a lot about the value. Because if I'm allowing myself to get depressed and down over my skin, then, you know, I definitely value and place a lot of value on my external beauty than I should have. So that was, getting acne really was a blessing in disguise in terms of redefining what actually is a value in life. So yeah, now I definitely have learned to value what's inside in terms of how I feel, and what brings me happiness, like setting goals and my education and like seeking knowledge and just, you know, doing things that, you know, I love to do.
What's it like having that power to just from being young and hot? Is that something you haven't thought much about? Is that power rush addictive, knowing how easily you can wrap men around your finger? Or is it, does it disgust you? Like, who are these weak men just being so easily led around by the visual impulse? What's that power like? Cause I've never been young and hot and female.
Yes, well, I actually learned about this concept in my rhetoric class in college called pretty privilege. And it definitely is a real thing where, I mean, I have been treated pretty good my whole life, and by even strangers, whether it's at a cashier and I'm checking out my groceries, whatever, you know, or, you know, people wanting to open the door for me and stuff, or people wanting to come up to me and get to know me. Like, yeah, there is pretty privilege. Like, you get more perks out of life. I'm not, definitely not going to deny that. And it's a real thing, but, and it's something that my other quote unquote hot friends have experienced too, and they can attest to it too. But it is a kind of a bad mindset to get into, especially with social media, that can be seriously detrimental to feeding your ego in the wrong way in terms of becoming really egotistical. Because knowing that you're hot and stuff and knowing that you could exploit that on social media and get reinforced for that, it could be challenging, because instead of focusing on things that you need to work inside of yourself, like childhood trauma or insecurities or whatever, you always know that you can have that to fall back on. And because of that, it could be being beautiful and pretty, I guess it's a blessing, but it could also be a curse, because people are not only, looking at you in that way and only thinking of you, and you're always wondering, okay, well, are they only looking at me for my looks and everything? A lot of people can just run with that in a bad way by becoming narcissists and getting their ego boosted by posting sexy pictures on Instagram and, really living off of the likes and the validation that people give them. And that's what I found too, that I was doing. I would be posting these sexy pictures knowing that I was hot shit and knowing, okay, I'm gonna get a bunch of likes, blah, blah, blah. Like, but really I found that, you know what? I'm just using this as a mask for my own insecurities. Cause I mean, it's so fleeting, that validation that you get. Like, okay, you'll post a photo, but that nice, that feeling and rush of getting likes and stuff, that's only gonna last for a short time. You know, it's like, in that social media world that you're trapped in, that's not a real world. You still have real life to deal with. Like, those people aren't really gonna care about you in the long run. They just, are doing social media etiquette, which is, oh my God, you're so hot, and like commenting just so they can get a comment back and stuff. And yeah, I learned to really not do those kind of shallow tasks, because it wasn't good for my mental health, and it was making me feel like I was better than everybody and making me judge everyone and, judging their appearance and stuff. It was just a very toxic thing. So I cut that out, and I learned to, find my purpose in life, which is adding value to other people's lives, making people be the best version of themselves, and cutting back from that. But yeah, pretty privilege is a good thing, and it's a blessing and it's a curse, in summary.
I'm just curious, how do you react to men who are so easily intoxicated? Do you view them as weak, or do you view them with compassion? Do you view them with contempt, or how do you react to men who are so easy to manipulate?
I really can't really speak for that, because I've been kind of weird with men. I've never felt the need. I've never had a boyfriend. I'll just say that there. I've had things and flings with like guys my age, but I've always had like my standards set high. And so if somebody's drunkenly flirting with me and like, I don't think he's like attractive or whatever, then I'm like, I'm kind of more turned off on the fact that he's sloppy in terms of, I guess his personality. I mean, I don't know. I've always thought that I was picky, and had high standards. I mean, that's why I've like waited so long to have a boyfriend, because I want him to meet all my requirements, so to speak, which is being mature, being humorous, being like both physically and mentally attractive to me in terms of what I value and stuff. So, I don't know, but I, with my friends, who are attractive too, I do see that they can be, very dismissive to these guys. And I mean, I guess I have been too, and I have fallen in the trap of being like, oh, okay, that guy's not as hot as I am, so he's not worth my time. Doing these self-improvement types of activities in my morning routine and stuff, and fixing my insecurities and stuff, I realize, you know what, I shouldn't be resonating at the shallow level. I want to get to know these people on a more like soul level, and who they are as a person. And so, yeah, I have fallen in the trap of just, paying attention to looks and seeing, okay, I don't want to like hook up with this guy or date this guy because we wouldn't look picture perfect together because he's uglier than me. And I've gotten out of that and have just instead focused on somebody based on the content of their character and who they are as a person and, you know, the values that they have. But yeah, I mean, some girls are different. Some girls, they never get out of like that pretty mindset. And social media definitely makes it worse because they're like, okay, well, this girl's just as hot as I am and she has a hot boyfriend. If I don't have a hot boyfriend, then it's going to be embarrassing because, you know, like people are going to judge me. And I mean, I've heard one girl say like, oh yeah, it's like a psychological thing. If like a hot girl is dating an ugly guy, you know, it shows like family issues. And I just think that's complete bogus. I don't know where she got that from, but it's like, you know, cause that reflected more on her. It's like, okay, well, why do you feel like she has to have a hot boyfriend, you know, just cause she's hot. Like maybe she just likes him for who he is. It's not all about looks. So yeah, it's a big thing to talk about.
Which of your accomplishments are you most proud of? What things have you done that fill you with the most pride?
Probably, I mean, my self-awareness and my work ethic and my ability to act on my self-awareness. Yeah, that has always been a huge thing. Because for me, growing up, like I was in the lacrosse team at high school and I never scored a goal. I was the bench warmer. So I always felt like shit, like feeling like I was just like unworthy and undeserving. And then, like I said earlier, I would fall in the trap of people pleasing with my high school friends and stuff. So me having kind of those codependent traits within me and breaking out of them with my morning routine and stuff, I think that's a big, good trait that I have with, who I am as a person, because a lot of people my age, they don't do the things that I do. They don't like want to have vision boards and, you know, want to think of, okay, 10 years from now, how they can start working now to be, you know, successful and have a good business and stuff like that. Whereas I'm willing to put in the work right now. I'm willing to acknowledge my faults. I'm willing to recognize patterns in my childhood that I had of being too codependent and breaking out of that and going within and meditating and fixing those like deep-seated insecurities and negative beliefs that I would tell myself and making an effort and a disciplined effort at that to fix those things. And I'm really proud of I pride myself in doing that because sometimes I beat myself up for not being at the finish line, but then I have to realize, you know what? There is no finish line. Like, it's all about the journey. And I'm really proud of myself for starting that journey now at 21 years old, when most people my age, and nothing wrong with, you know, what they do. Everyone has their own path and they get to their spiritual path at their own time when they need to, based on their lived experiences. But yeah, a lot of people my age, they just go out and drink and they party and they smoke, or, you know, they want to be lazy. They want to watch reality TV and binge watch, or they just kind of fall into the routine of just going to school and never asking, okay, what more do I want for myself? Like, just because I'm young doesn't mean I can't start doing things that'll benefit me in the future and benefit me in the now also. So it's something that I do pride myself, just kind of being self-aware of myself and what I need to work on and acting on that self-awareness.
Are you willing to share your vision for your life or some parts of your vision? What are you driving towards?
Yes. So ever since I was a little girl, I would imagine myself being like the news reporter. And like kind of like the anchors that you see on Fox, CNN, MSNBC, because I would sit in the living room and my parents would pay all their attention to these people on the news. And I was like, you know what? These people must be really important, or they must have really good things to say if my parents aren't paying attention to me and they're not wanting to play with me because they have to listen to these people. And I made that decision when I was little. I was like, I want to be just like them. So when we would go on family vacations, my dad, he would get out his camera and he would like record me reporting the news, like quote unquote, like fake news, like actual fake news. I would like just be like, oh, okay, like we're here in like Hawaii, breaking news, or like on this vacation in Hawaii, and we're about to go swim with dolphins, or we're about to go hike on this mountain, or we're gonna swim the pool, or whatever. And so I'm glad that he was so supportive of me and of my vision, my goal, me wanting to be a reporter, and me kind of exercising those communication skills at an early age, and being, you know, supportive of my vision. So yeah, I would do that. And then once I got into high school, I decided to be the school reporter for our school news, Beach City News. And then in my community college, El Camino, which is in Torrance, I was also the school reporter. And then in college, I got this internship that I am still kind of on and off with, but it's basically being the entertainment reporter for Life Bites Global. And I really like it because we look at movies that are currently out in theaters and then find the inspirational value within these movies, and kind of make our own little script that I recite. And I say, like, one-on-one with the camera on how the characters, how they acted in movies, and how we can take their actions into their own lives as a learning lesson, or for how we should react to, you know, traumatic situations or events and things like that. So I really liked how their mission statement of Life Bites is using the power of entertainment to transform people's lives. And that kind of got me into being like, okay, I want to be a reporter, but I really like the message of Life Bites too, and what they strive to do. So that is kind of leading me to now focusing, okay, what do I want to do as a career where I can still report and stuff, but add value? And that maybe want to be a TV personality. And eventually my long career goal is having my own talk show host, or my own podcast. And I'm definitely going to start on YouTube soon. I'm going to start a YouTube channel where I share my insights and what I've learned from reading books and my own personal experiences. And yeah, and eventually big goal is giving a TED talk. hopefully that'll come too. But yeah, I think a long-term career goal is just to make a brand out of me and myself and be my own like TV personality, and just to fulfill my purpose, which is to add value to the lives of others. So that's what I see myself in.
Yeah, this girl that I knew ever since she was an infant. I went to a Sukkot, it's a Jewish holiday, went to the home of her dad for a meal, and there she was, and she's now doing the weather on one of LA's main TV stations.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Right on. It's like, and I knew her like when she was, you know, an infant, and now she's doing the weather on TV. So at what age did you decide you wanted to be on TV doing the news?
Oh, I was probably like 7 years old when I started looking at my parents and then watching the news. And yeah, it just always stuck on me being a reporter. I never changed that aspiration, I guess you could say, because I don't know. Yeah, just talking with people. I guess it's because I wanted what they were always presenting themselves to be, these anchors, which is confident in their words, like, you know, being able to be articulate and carry like whatever they were saying very well. And I always aspired to be like that. And I was like, wow, you know, these people are leaders. And I guess it just, you know, fulfilled that need inside of me to be a leader if I was going to be a reporter. But obviously I learned throughout my years of being here and growing older that, you know, they have a lot of education and stuff. And I already have those skills inside of me. I just need to perfect them, and I need to stop having this story in my head where, you know, I'm not confident or I'm not already a good speaker. Like, I am, and that's why I love positive affirmations. You act as if you already have it, and you're way more likely to achieve the goal that you have. So yeah.
Excellent. Which academic subjects have you enjoyed the most, and which have you found the most challenging?
I'm really bad at math, so those, I would always hated math and science, especially chemistry. I was never a fan. But let's see. subjects that I've always liked, language arts growing up. But now in college, now that I'm at the communications school at LMU, within that school, I think the classes that I like the most was this class called Wires and Empires. And I really liked it because it was a global communication class. So we were given like very real life scenarios and had to really use our critical thinking skills to think, okay, how would we solve this? So for example, in this class, there was this prompt and it was like, okay, the people in Myanmar, they're just getting introduced to Facebook and they equate Facebook with the internet because it is their only form of internet there. And because they're new to Facebook, they don't know Facebook social etiquette. So they're saying all this hate speech about Muslims that are in Myanmar. And since the Burmese language is not like a very common language, this hate speech is getting detected, which is leading to these Muslims being like rioted against and like, you know, these acts of violence happening on the streets. So if you were Mark Zuckerberg, what would you do in this scenario, given that you've already hired a bunch of Burmese language detectors for Facebook and the problem is still occurring? So it's like, oh, wow, what would you do? And we'd always be given these prompts that where there's no right or wrong answer. You really have to like think. And that was what was challenging. It's like, okay, I'm so used to like, okay, with math, you know, there's always a right answer. Or even with like writing a prompt, it's like, okay, if you get these like points down that the teacher is asking you to talk about, then you're going to get a good essay grade. But this, it's like, oh my gosh, anything goes. So it really was challenging and it put me out of my comfort zone. And I liked that. So I've always liked courses that challenged me because it's so rewarding when you get an A and you work hard and you're like, wow, okay, I did that because hard work and persistence and, you know, really not taking no for an answer. Because some people, they failed because they gave up on the prompts and stuff. But I really saw it through and was like, okay, I'm going to do this. So yes, I love writing classes, classes that are related to public speaking, to sociology, psychology, getting inside the brain, knowing why we do what we do. Those have always fascinated me.
And where do you come out on big tech censoring hate speech? Where do you think it's appropriate for Facebook and for YouTube and for Twitter to ban people or to delete hate speech? Is hate speech even a real category? Is it something that can be objectively defined? Did you develop any thoughts on this?
Yes, and that was what was so hard because our teacher, even when we came up with solutions, he would still debate us and refute them. And and he would just reiterate the point that there really is no solution. So in my paper, I wrote that even though Burmese is the main language there, there's still like 7 other languages, I think, that they use, like 5 or 7. I forget the number. So I'd make sure that Facebook hired as many language detectors from each of those minority languages so that hate speech could be better detected. But yeah, I mean, there is a gray area of what is determined hate speech and what isn't. So in my proposal, I also said that Facebook should have like a disclaimer or an ad video showing how other people around the world use Facebook and that it's not just for hate speech and that they use it for like, you know, as a sense of community and to build and support each other up. So if I were the CEO, I would like play that ad across Myanmar. So like people have a better understanding there of how it works. But yeah, it was a hard prompt to address and to write about. So, but that was all I could offer. So I don't really know what would actually be practical because people, if they have hate within them, they're going to find a way to say it and speak it out. So there really is no like solution without any negative consequences happening.
How Roman Catholic is Loyola Marymount?
We're Jesuits. It's a Jesuit institution based on like the Ignatian values. So we have a church on our campus, but I mean, it's not like, too religious. I mean, I know a lot of agnostic and atheist people that attend school there and who are students and teachers as well. So it's not really forced upon you, but you do have to take as a requirement, like a religious-based course, but it doesn't have to be like about Catholicism. You have this option to choose like a meditation course or, you know, a psychological course that analyzes like religion. So I like that about them, where it's like, even though they're Jesuit and stuff, they don't force, even in their religious requirement, like a specific religion that you have to study. Like it's very, fits each person's needs. So if you're more on like the atheist or agnostic side, maybe you just take the psychology of religion course. But maybe if you actually are a Christian or Catholic, then you'll take the Catholic course. So they understand that, and they don't try to be like pushy of a religion.
Right. It's interesting when you were talking about what led you to take up marijuana. I think you mentioned several people had moved away. And so it makes me think about how we're wired to connect. And if we don't connect to other people, if we don't connect to our higher purpose in life, if we don't connect to the transcendent or to our calling, if we're not on our life's mission, then we've got to connect to something. And so for some people it'll be marijuana, for other people alcohol, for other people it'll be pornography, for other people it'll be sports, for other people it'll be Netflix, for other people it'll be overeating. So it seems like you really needed to connect, and marijuana was a way for you to feel connected. It was to a substance to replace perhaps the people that you had in your life or the lack of purpose at that time.
Yes. Yeah, both. yeah, because like I said, the cue is boredom, and also, being, I guess, alone with my thoughts and feeling like I had to go outside of myself and rely on something else for happiness, since I was so used to that, like, okay, relying on friends for happiness. So like weed was just another form of an external source. It like kind of was a friend to me, like, okay, I can count on it, I can like hang out with it, so to speak, by smoking it. The lack of purpose that I had in my life, because I didn't know who I was. I would always, you know, have other people shape the opinions that I had, and I was always like a gullible person. So anything like anyone would tell me or anything I would hear or read, I would adopt that as my own belief and regurgitate it, trying to like make it seem like this is who I am. But no, it's not. I just like took that insight from somebody else. it definitely was the two, just a lack of purpose and boredom and loneliness and, you know, feeling the need to connect with something, even if it wasn't good for my health, like, because it made me feel less alone.
Do you have any all-time favorite books that you've read? Books perhaps that have most influenced you or most enchanted you?
Probably The Miracle Morning by Hal Elrod. And I just actually finished Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich. And after finishing it, I understand why it's such a big bestseller, because it really is detailed in terms of what you need to do to be successful. And what I noticed with a lot of these books is mind over matter, like just acting as if you already have what you want, and, you know, having this like belief in yourself and this faith that you, and this determination and persistence that you will get that which you seek. And, you know, you are a product of what you promote. So you're promoting good thoughts within yourself, and you're promoting good service, and you act on it, and you're diligent with it, and you don't take no for an answer. And you don't let failure get in the way of that, and you see failure as not rejection but redirection, then anything is possible and the world is at your oyster. And Think and Grow Rich, he has this Napoleon Hill, this very strategic tactic to get readers to finish it, the book, because he says in the first chapter, there's this secret and you're going to uncover it. It's within every chapter. If you already know the secret, you can stop reading it. But if not, then you know, you have to find it within each chapter of the book and stuff. And for me, I think in my personal sense, I was like, you know what, this was strategic, because he just wants you to finish his book and like buy other books that were made by him. But there is no like one secret. The secret is subjective based on, you know, everyone's own lived experiences. And I think the secret is right in the title of the book, Think and Grow Rich. So if you have these positive thoughts and if you affirm yourself and you're confident in yourself and your abilities and you don't take no for an answer, then yeah, you're going to grow rich, both in terms of rich of mind, charitable of heart, you know, rich in the soul. Like it doesn't have to be like rich in terms of money, like, you know, it's wealthy in terms of like everything, finances, health, all of that. So I really like that book.
Okay, great. So I'm going to move on here to my own solo stream, but do you have any final words, Erica?
No, other than, you know, I promote people to just meditate, go within, and yeah, once again, habits, they're a loop. It's key, routine, reward. You can't break a habit. You can only change it. So really, you know, sit with yourself and get into the literal habit of every time you notice something within yourself, if it's something you want to change, have a notepad out, identify your triggers, you know, what time it took place, who you're with, whether you're alone or not, and change the routine that still gets you the same reward as the bad routine that you were doing before. And then you'll see some positive changes in your life happen.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Erica. Good to talk to you. Take care.
Yes. Nice talking to you. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Bye-bye. Okay. So that was Erica, and we're talking about a book, The Power of Habits. So look here, it's on Amazon, The Power of Habit, Why We Do What We Do in Life and Business by Charles Duhigg, a longtime New York Times and LA Times journalist. I'm going to share some of my thoughts on the book soon, but let me play a little bit from Charles Duhigg giving a speech for TED. So here he is.
Let's say you work in a building in Midtown that's called the New York Times, and on the 14th floor is this cafeteria with this amazing, amazing cookie selection. And you put this little note on your monitor that says, do not eat the cookie. And then every afternoon you manage to ignore that note and go upstairs and get a cookie. And imagine for a minute that this has caused you to put on a little bit of weight. Let's say roughly 8.7 pounds. And when I say you, what I actually mean is me, because I'm describing my life eating cookies. So I was really interested in why I, a successful human being, I won a Pulitzer Prize last week, I think I'm a pretty smart guy, why I have this difficulty resisting cookies, right? There's a lot of things that I can do in my life. And I began researching the science of habits, how habits work. And what I learned is that we're actually living through this golden age of understanding the neurology of habit formation. And I ended up writing this book out of it. And I want to tell you a little bit about what I learned and what it has to do with teaching kids and mindfulness. But in order to do that, I first of all have to tell you a story about a rat. Anyone here ever experiment with rats before? Anyone ever ride the subway? Okay, then you've done a lot of experience with rats. There's a woman named Dr. Anne Graybeal who has for years been doing experiments with rats. She's a neurologist. And for years, she was trying to get sensors into rats' craniums so she could measure what was going on inside their skulls. This took a long time and a lot of rats. But eventually, she got to a point when she could get about 150 sensors inside a rat's skull, and she could measure its neurological activity. What she'd do with each rat after it woke up from the surgery was the exact same thing. She would drop it in the world's simplest maze. Works the same way every single time. Click, a partition would move, the rat's free to run through the maze and find the chocolate. Every rat, when you drop it in the maze the first time, acts like the world's laziest animal.
Hey everybody,
it'll,
Dr. Zubin.
Wander up and down, it'll get to the end, it'll see the chocolate, it'll go the other direction. It takes on average about 13 minutes for it to find the chocolate. And for years, people thought that this is because rats are unusually dumb, and that if a rat can learn something, then any animal could learn it. But Dr. Graybeal could actually see inside the rat's head, and what she saw was kind of fascinating. This is a simplified neurological graph the first time a rat's dropped in this maze. There's all these spikes in activity, right? Basically, the rat would like scratch the walls and the scratching centers of its brain would light up, or it'd find the chocolate and the pleasure centers would light up. This is what unmediated learning looks like. So Dr. Graybeal takes this rat. She drops each of them in the maze again and again, 150 times each. Over time, unsurprisingly, the rat learns how to run through the maze faster and faster and faster, find the chocolate. But what's really interesting is what happens inside its head. As the rat learns to run faster and faster, as finding the chocolate becomes more of an automatic habit, the rat starts thinking less and less and less. This graph on the bottom is a simplified neurological graph of the 150th iteration through that maze. What you'll notice is this deep valley there, right? That's the same valley you would see if the rat went to sleep. Now, all of us have habits, right? There's a researcher named Wendy Wood who followed around a couple thousand people to see how much of our daily behaviors are habits. And what she found is about 40 to 45% of the decisions we make actually every day aren't actually decisions, they're habits. And if somehow I could get 150 sensors into your head, this is exactly what I would see. Your mental activity dropping off in the middle of that habit. When you remember waking up in the morning and walking in the subway, and now you're at your desk, but you don't remember what happened in the middle. Or when you decided that morning to have a salad, but you get to lunch and you order a hamburger just like you did yesterday. This is what's happening. Your brain is kind of turning off. With these two interesting exceptions, at the beginning of the habit, when the rat would hear the click, there'd be this burst of activity. And then essentially the brain would power down. And then at the end, when it found the chocolate, it's as if the rat would sort of shake itself awake again and notice what was going on. Within neurology, this is such an important idea and finding that it's become known as the habit loop. And what it says is that every habit has three components. There's a cue, which is like an automatic trigger for a behavior to start. And then a routine, which is the behavior itself. And then finally, a reward that helps your brain remember that pattern for the future. Every habit has cues and rewards. And for years, everyone from Aristotle to Oprah, when they've talked about habits, they've focused on the routine, on the behavior. But what we've learned in the last decade is that it's the cue and the reward that influence how habits function. Just to give you an example of this, does anyone here exercise? It's a young audience. Anyone here wish that they exercise on a regular basis? Okay, so there was an experiment that was done in Germany where they took an audience like this and they said, all of you should exercise. And then they took about a third of the audience and they said, okay, look, this is what I want you to do. Choose a cue, like always put your running shoes next to your bed or go running with the same group of friends. And then when you get back from working out, give yourself a small piece of chocolate, right? This is counterintuitive because not many people exercise in order to eat chocolate, or at least not quite that directly. And yet what the researchers suspected is that even though all of you think that you want to exercise, your brain thinks you're a liar and that you hate exercise. And the only way that I can trick you in exercise is to give yourself a reward you genuinely enjoy, like a small piece of chocolate.
Okay, I had some thoughts of my own on this book. I recommend it. There are problems with it, but it's definitely worth reading if you're interested in habits. So for me, self-help books and self-help approaches did me no good as long as I had active emotional addictions running my life, because I couldn't see what I couldn't see. I didn't know what I didn't know. I didn't have an accurate sense of myself and my relative importance in my various interactions. So a book on habits, to be effective, it presupposes that we can see things fairly clearly. But if you're listening to this stream, if you're watching this stream, you're a very smart person. And if your problems were really your problems, they wouldn't be your problems anymore. You would have solved them already because you're so smart. So my approach is that now I look at my problems as stimuli to work my 12-step program. I have stopped thinking of my problems as being my problems because I know I'm a fairly smart guy. If they were really my problems, if the surface issues were really what was troubling me, then I could deal with it. But I can't see what I can't see. I don't know what I don't know. I don't always have an accurate sense of myself and of reality. And so I take problems that crop up when I bump into things as I go through life, when I have turbulence in my life, then I take that as a stimulus to work my 12-step program and to get more connected to God, to my higher power, and to my highest purpose in life of being of the maximum amount of service to other people, trying to help my sponsees, help other people. And that's how I react to my problems. If something, you know, blindsides me, I try to react by going through the first three steps. I can't, you can, I'll let you. I can't, God can, I'll let him. That's how I reset myself when I get blindsided by life. I remember I was thinking about going to these various 12-step programs with regard to money for years before I ever actually went. And I talked to people who were also 12-steppers. It's like, oh, yeah, I'm going to go to Debtors Anonymous one day. I'm going to go to Under Owners Anonymous one day. I might go to Financial Under Owners Anonymous one day. And I didn't do it until finally my new computer broke down. I had to ship it away to Tennessee to get it repaired. And so then I had open evenings And so I finally went to my first 12-step meeting regarding my financial problems. And that very first meeting, my life transformed. I kind of grokked the program in my first meeting. I started making new friends. I found a new community. And then I started going to those meetings pretty much every day. And the chat says, Luke, I thought 95% of your viewers were antisocial. I think a majority of my viewership has fairly strong antisocial tendencies. But Bernard is part of the 5% who doesn't have any antisocial tendencies. And another thing that I disagree with this book on, he puts forward the idea that you can do anything if you set your mind to it, and you just can't. People have talents or lack thereof. I remember when I was getting voice lessons, I decided one day, hey, I should learn how to sing. And when we started to work on that, I realized that I really did not have any talent in singing, that I could really work on it and become serviceable, but I was not a gifted singer. So no matter how much I put my mind to it, I would never be a great singer. That's just not going to happen. No matter how much I put my mind on it, I was never going to become a fast runner. Just the shape of my feet will not allow me to be a fast runner. Generally speaking, the bigger the brain, the slower the runner. Because the bigger the brain means you need to have wider hips to support that big, heavy head. The bigger the brain correlates with IQ. And so generally speaking, bigger brain, slower runner, faster runner, smaller brain. So you'll find, for example, professional football players, the fastest ones who play on defense usually have the lowest Wunderlich scores, lowest IQ scores. The highest IQ scores are generally for the offensive line, who are trying to build something while the defense is just trying to destroy. So another problem with the book is that the author claims that grit determines success more than any other factor. So there's a certain Malcolm Gladwell naivete and nonsense to parts of this book. He seems to take various academics' word for things. He decides that the reason that the Baltimore Colts finally won a Super Bowl under Tony Dungy, I think he'd lost 10 straight championship games, meaning AFC or NFC championship games, and then finally the Colts got to the Super Bowl and they beat the Bears, and he attributes the reason is that his team had come to believe. Well, there may be many reasons, but Patriots were not good the year that the Colts finally won the Super Bowl under Tony Dungy, and they had the pleasure of playing a very flawed team, the Chicago Bears, in the Super Bowl, and then they never won any more Super Bowls after that. So what, did his team suddenly lose the ability to believe? Is that what happened? All right, let's get more here from Charles Duhigg.
Each year, Microsoft...
The author of this book, and I'll mention, and might be why some of you are here, that at the Times, I don't actually write about habits. I'm writing a series called The Eye Economy about Apple and looking at Apple's working conditions overseas and sort of using Apple as a lens. I imagine a number of people in this audience feel strongly about Apple and perhaps have read that series. If you have any questions about it, feel free to ask me. But right now, I'll just talk about habits, which is another way of saying, also, if you have any questions during this presentation, feel free to raise your hand and interrupt me. I'd love to, particularly if you think that what I'm saying is totally untrue or doesn't make any sense. Those are my favorite kinds of questions. So feel free to tell me that you totally disagree. So the book that I wrote, The Power of Habit, started about 10 years ago when I was a reporter in Iraq. And I had been sent over to Iraq because I thought it would be very interesting to be in a war zone. I had never been in a war zone before. Turns out it is very interesting. It's also terrifying and awful. And so I figured out pretty quickly that my number one goal in Iraq was to be in places where no one could shoot at me, which turns out to be harder than I thought it would be. But so I heard about this one army major about an hour south of Baghdad that was doing this experiment in a city named Kufa. Kufa was one of these towns where riots would break out all the time and people were being killed. And so the army major had been sent down to Kufa, and his assignment was stop the riots. So this guy shows up, he studies a whole bunch of videotapes of riots that were shot by drones. He goes to the town mayor and he says, a whole laundry list of requests. And his last request is, can you take all the food vendors out of the plazas in Kufa? And the mayor, who's dealing with suicide bombers and, you know, all types of terrible stuff, says, sure, sure, I can take all the food vendors out. That's the easiest thing you've asked me to do. So a couple weeks later, this crowd starts growing in around the Grand Mosque of Kufa, which is this very contentious mosque. And the crowd gets bigger and bigger over time. And what the army major explained to me is that when riots happen, they take hours to develop. Like on the news, it looks like they just broke out, right? But those people have been in that plaza for hours and hours and hours until eventually something kind of sparks and the entire crowd goes wild. So the crowd grows and grows and grows and grows. Time goes by, gets bigger and bigger and bigger. It gets to about 5:30. People are hungry and they start looking for all the food vendors that they normally buy kebabs from. And they're not there. So the people at the outer ring of this crowd go home because they're hungry and they're just spectators. And then the people who are one ring in see these people leaving and think to themselves, where are they going? The party must be someplace else. Like, why am I hanging out if everyone else? So they leave. And then the people one ring in, they leave as well, until eventually you get to these rabble rousers who are the people who start the riot in the first place. And they look around and realize there's nobody there. So they go home. And over the 9-month period that the major had been there, there hadn't been any riots. So when I talked to this guy, I was totally fascinated by this. I could talk to him in a very well-fortified building where no one could shoot at me. And so I had asked as many questions as I could. And I said, how did you know that this was going to happen, that removing the food vendors would do this? Because there had been riots for years in Kufa. And what he said was that the military is essentially this huge habit experiment, right? When you enroll, is anyone a veteran? I don't know if anyone... Oh, okay, so a couple of people. So you know this far better than I do. When you enroll in the military, basically their whole goal is to teach you these new habits, right? Like when people are shooting at you, instead of running away like sensible people do, stand there and shoot back. Or more importantly, how do you get along with people that you can't stand? Or how do you make decisions when you're exhausted or when you're under fire? Or how do you talk to your spouse when you're on another continent? Or even just spending habits? How do you save money? The military is this huge, huge laboratory for changing habits. And what this major told me is that once you start looking at the world through the lens of these habits, once you sort of understand how they work, all of a sudden everything looks different. And you understand that a riot can be stopped by taking away the food vendors.
So yeah, there's a strong Malcolm Gladwell quality to his writing, which to me is not a compliment. Though I still overall recommend this book. I prefer books by PhDs, by experts rather than by journalists. PhDs are experts in a particular field. Journalists just go around and interview people, and then they choose stories and ideas that pop, pop, pop. So they're looking for some pop. They're looking for some pop. They're looking for some angle, right? They're looking for an attention-grabbing concept or idea, and then they retail it just because it pops. And... So I'm suspicious of this approach. Here are some excerpts. Students who exerted high levels of willpower were more likely to earn higher grades in their classes and gain admission into more selective schools. Well, guess what? No matter how much willpower you have, if you have an IQ under 110, you're not going to do calculus. Probably if you have an IQ under 115, you're never going to do calculus, no matter, or maybe at 115, but at 110 and lower, you're never going to be able to do calculus. You're never going to do physics. You're never going to do... chemistry, all right? No matter how much willpower or grit. The author Charles Duhigg writes, they had fewer absences and spent less time watching television, more hours on homework. Highly self-disciplined adolescents outperformed their more impulsive peers on every academic performance variable. Well, impulsive is another correlates with low IQ because higher IQ people see the consequences of their actions more clearly than lower IQ people. Higher IQ people are living in the future because they see how things are playing out, and so they can see the consequences much more clearly. Self-discipline predicted academics' performance more robustly than did IQ. I doubt it. I don't buy it because there are a lot of subjects where you need a minimum 115 IQ to do them, such as even... beginning calculus, let alone higher levels of chemistry or physics. Self-discipline also predicted which students would improve their grades over the course of the school year, whereas IQ did not. I'm skeptical. Self-discipline has a bigger effect on academic performance than does intellectual talent. That's nonsense. I don't buy that at all. Someone with a 110 IQ is just not going to be doing calculus. They're not going to be doing physics. So I sense that the author credulously believes academic studies that pop, 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 similar to Malcolm Gladwell, because if they further his agenda, he embraces them. So many of the times that I've been interviewed by journalists, I'm just a placeholder for their story that's already written in their head. And they're just looking for me to say certain things that further their planned thesis. So I'm just a prop. They're not really present. They're just looking for me to fulfill their agenda. Here's more from the book. Cultures grow out of the keystone habits in every organization. When researchers studied an incoming class of cadets at West Point, they measured their grade point averages, physical aptitude, military abilities, and self-discipline. When they correlated those factors with whether students dropped out or graduated, they found that all of them mattered less than a factor researchers referred to as grit, which they defined as the tendency to work strenuously toward challenges, maintaining effort and interest over years, despite failure, adversity, and plateaus in progress. Well, this is essentially the personality trait of conscientiousness. And personality traits are at least substantially genetic. So grit is simply conscientiousness. And grit won't get you through calculus if you don't have the cognitive capacity to do calculus. And Charles Murray notes that once you get close to a six-figure income, added grit does not associate with higher income. Okay, further increases in grit don't really make much difference if you don't have the innate talent. And this book embodies an annoying journalistic habit from my point of view, that you always explain an important statistic or explain something important by using these lengthy personal anecdotes. So if you're going to do a story about homelessness, it starts out with Joe Blow, who's been smoking crack and living behind the corner liquor store for the past 5 years. And much of this book is filled with anecdotes that if you're simply interested in mechanisms to change your habits, you can just skip them. All right, let me play more from the author.
So I thought this was totally fascinating. So I came back to the US and I started researching about studies that were going on around the science of habit formation. And let me just start by telling you what a habit is, at least for purposes of this talk, which is a habit is a decision that you made at some point and then stopped making but continued acting on.
So I thought I had a low viewership, but look at Joe Biden. Joe Biden is live on YouTube right now trying to grow his presence, and he's got 618 people.
For possible exposure, and 12 members have tested positive for COVID-19. Additionally, we all have families. So if I'm being quarantined, then I am possibly exposing my family members to this, because not everyone has the resources to put themselves up in a hotel or stay away from their families. Now, Vice President, we absolutely understand the inherent risk that comes with our jobs, and we do it gladly. We run to the front lines every time, doing what we have to do, what we've signed up to do. But I think it would give us peace to know that if something were to happen to us, that we would be taken care of equally. So that leads into my question. What is your opinion on prioritizing testing for first responders who have been exposed to COVID-19 so that we can get back out into the field doing our job, but also to give ourselves a peace of mind that we are not exposing our loved ones and, you know, the citizens that we serve to this virus?
Well, first of all, to state the obvious, Tony, thank you, pal. And, you know, I've had this discussion with your the president of your international and the vice president.
So Joe Biden's definitely far more likable than Hillary, but doesn't exactly resonate with the competence. Here's the president.
Legislation.
Right. Come on, here's the
because
president.
Of this legislation, they now have a great chance of that. And those people that work for small businesses or shutter now will be paid. That's really important. This wouldn't have passed without your leadership, Mr. President. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And, you know, Eric worked so hard. You all know Eric. And he was at Steve's side the whole way. And where is our man? Do I see Larry? Yeah, Larry. The two of them. How about Eric? And then Larry, say a couple of words. And
Well, thank you very much, Mr. President. I really appreciate it.
I don't claim
Mr. Vice
that
President as well. So, You encourage your team to be bold, be brave, and go big. And we certainly delivered today. $6.2 trillion is tremendous. So we've made sure that we can reassure America.
Okay, let's hear Dr. Drew Pinsky on coronavirus.
Debating the media, but my God, their reporting is absolutely reprehensible. They should be ashamed of themselves. They are creating a panic that is far worse than the viral outbreak. The bottom line, everybody, is listen to Anthony Fauci at the CDC, do what he tells you, and go about your business. That's the story. There's not one doctor I've spoken to that disagrees with me, not one. I ran into an agreement with Dr. Oz last night. He was saying the same thing. We're all telling you the same thing. Stop listening to journalists. They don't know what they're talking about. Listen to the CDC, listen to Anthony Fauci, and do not listen to anybody else. This is the job of those people. They are highly trained professionals. They know what they're doing. Just follow their direction. You know, I saw CNN reporters this morning talking to an infectious disease doctor from Vanderbilt, a very fine infectious disease doctor, but I wanted to scream at him, tell these people to stop. Tell the press to stop. They went, oh, my God, what about the testing? And we don't have testing. And the doctor just simply calmly went, no, we have private and public testing. We're rolling it out. We have it. We have the same as other countries. Oh, but we don't. Shut up. We do. And by the way, you don't test people willy-nilly. The way medical tests are done is you have criteria for the test. Doctors determine that criteria. You apply the test. Testing randomly is called a...
So I just saw this tweet by Ayella Girl on Twitter. She's the co-founder of AskHall.io. She tweets, sometimes it feels surreal that there's so little rape. Men are stronger and hornier, and I am just so grateful that we live in a society where they just constantly go around not raping. Like half of all non-human sex is rape, but we managed to get our rape down to a tiny percentage. Diana Fleischman responds, reminds me of my friend who went to India for 2 months. She told me I had a great time. I only got groped once. Mark responds, species of bed bugs have evolved a homosexual stabbing rape strategy where males will rape other males through their abdomen to replace the sperm of their victim. We're really very peaceful by a lot of measures. Humans are unusual for not displaying any signals of their peak fertility. Can't remember where I heard it, but one possible explanation is this is to reduce rape. I have a yard full of ducks. It's like a 3-acre wall-to-wall rape fest around here. Humans have no clue how lucky we are. We didn't get that particular biological imperative switch triggered. Not much rape, but plenty of coercion and lying. Somehow, by both acknowledging it happens and making a charitable assessment of it, you will manage to annoy many on both sides. And there's this old dude on Twitter holding up a sign, yes, I'm a man, now I'm not going to rape you. Todd responds, rape in the animal kingdom is nowhere close to half of all sexual encounters. And Ayella responds, oh, you're right, I misread from Wikipedia. Indeed, in orangutans, close human relatives, copulations of this nature may account for up to half of all observed matings. Chimps have a promiscuous mating style that makes it almost impossible to tell in many cases what counts as rape. But look at places where society breaks down, such as civil wars, men revert to pretty brutal behavior easily. Ayella. I know the thing standing between me and getting raped is like some sort of general cultural agreement, and that's super surreal. Wow. This girl's interesting check. Nobody eats anyone's head afterwards. Society gave both men and women what they wanted, a beast in a dinner jacket. Credit should go to civilization, not to individual men. Wars tell a different story. Culture must play a role. When Germany fell in World War II, the Russian armies were conducting mass rape throughout Germany, but not the Jewish soldiers, not the Jewish officers, Russian Jewish officers. They were not raping. The Allied armies, not so much. Any invading army rapes its way through the population. If half of all sex in a state of nature is rape, then that's a pretty good defense of the Hobbesian position and a pretty strong indictment of the Rousseauian position. Cassie, it's great how safe I can feel walking around New York City. Maybe the emotional responses that this tweet and discussion will inevitably generate are an intuitive sensing of how thin the line between civilized restraint and the state of nature really is. You can say that of assault in general. We come from a violent world, yet the vast majority of humans don't assault each other sexually or otherwise. Just as with rape, we find assault so jarring, we inflate its prevalence. It's called rationale. You can't go to a friend's house and just grab whatever you want. That is their stuff. A woman's and a man's body is their stuff. No one has the right to take it. Is this quarantine thoughts, or would you have tweeted this anyway? Now I know why you have so many followers. I've never thought of this. Probably would never have thought of this one on my own. What's surreal is that many core family structures and social practices were originally developed to deter and mitigate against rape. Weird, I had the same thought last night while watching an old noir movie called The Fuzzy Pink Nightgown. There are several scenes after the female lead is kidnapped where her being raped and her inability to stop it is hinted at. Wasn't expecting that in a 1950s movie. Even the remnants of a proper patriarchy is a powerful force of good. Amount of rape. Society where women can't vote, own property, make their own life decisions will have an insurmountably higher amount of rape, says someone else. Lockdown seemed to be drawing out your fantasies, Mistress Ayella. I would help you out consensually, but only if you admit that it is females that are hornier than men. This seems backhanded. You really think men are capable of constantly going around raping people simply because of how much stronger and hornier we are? Ayella, I don't think men experience this as an active struggle to not rape. I think culture instills this well. I'm also not sure how old it is. Like, females have protective males to discourage rape seems like maybe a really old thing. And another response here. I see you've only been encouraged by the response to your bestiality tweet. You'd be surprised what Africans do in Africa and what Africans and Arabs do in the USA and Europe. There's plenty of rape going on in middle schools and high schools by middle-aged single women. Okay, and it's times like this that I wonder what does Louis C.K. have to say about these things?
I mean, what am I capable of? I'd like to think that I'm a nice person, but I don't know, man. A lot of it is context. There's a lot of things I wonder if the world was different. Like, if murder was legal, I might have killed a few people. I don't know. I'd love to think, oh, I would never do that. But we really need the law against murder. For one simple reason. The law against murder is the number one thing preventing murder. We'd like to think it's because, like, oh, I would never do that. No, it's because it really sucks getting caught murdering. A lot. If murder was legal, or just a misdemeanor, like you get a thing in the mail, ah, shit, they had a camera there. Oh, well. If murder was legal, there would be so much murder. Regular people would murder. Murderers would murder even more. And then really nice, sweet people would murder a few people. But nobody would murder no people. You wouldn't trust somebody who didn't murder if murder was legal. You wouldn't like them. I never killed anybody. Okay, nice meeting you. Ugh. What a creep. I mean, not even a hooker. Live a life. What's wrong with
that? Whoa! Disavow.
He's like a Mormon or some shit. I hate those guys. I think he's nice. Shut up, Janet. It would just... If murder was legal, there would be a lot of murder. Children would behave very differently. Because mostly parents would be murdering their own kids. That's mostly what would happen.
Wow, Louis C.K. going there. And got an email. Steve Mnuchin has neurological damage, tardive dyskinesia of the mouth. He has involuntary movements of his mouth. Watch him closely in any video. Probably from psychiatric drugs. Let's get back to Louis C.K.
Murder was legal. You'd be, you know, you go to a mall, there'd be like eight different moms in the mall just, I told you to stop it! You didn't listen to me! Just... There'd be just, you'd be stepping over dead kids. It'd be like a new problem. You have to clean up your kids when you kill them, because it's gross. It's bad for the environment. If you murder your child in a public place, please use one of the red bags that are in the dispensers every 3 feet of America. Put your murdered child in the red bag with a logo of a murdered kid on it next to the other logo that tells you not to let your alive kid play with a plastic bag because they might suffocate. In which case, you could just leave him in the bag. That is a whole bunch of horrible thoughts right in a row. Right in a row. That is a compressed area of bad thought.
Wow, Louis C.K. He went there. All right, here's a rabbi saying anti-Semitism doesn't exist.
Everyone's all into anti-Semitism right now. It's the hot topic that everyone wants to jump on. There is no such thing. Yes, Esav son of Yaakov. The Goyim are not on the level of Esav because we're not on the level of Yaakov. So Esav son of Yaakov, it exists. I'm not saying it doesn't. Anti-Semitism exists. I'm not saying it's not, but it's not.
So that Hebrew phrase he's saying refers to it's the nature of Esav to hate Yaakov, meaning it's the nature of the non-Jew to hate the Jew. But the rabbi here is making the point that we're not, Yaakov, we're not as righteous as the patriarch Jacob. This is referring to a particular time and place. And so this phrase isn't really the explanation of what's going on now.
Not real. It's up to us. If Jews treat other Jews like garbage, the Goyim take that and they run with it. They try to kill us. It's just the way it works. If we want to end anti-Semitism, we want to actually battle anti-Semitism, it's not happening in a courtroom. It's not happening in a legislation somewhere. It's happening in our four walls. It's what we teach our children. It's what we do in shul. It's how we treat our neighbor, which brings us to our Mishnah.
You've just experienced a...
Okay, I like that. I like that. So, who is this rabbi? Rabbi Yossi Ben Susa.
Everyone's all into anti-Semitism right now.
Okay. So let's get back to Dr.
Drew. The screening test, that's no longer a diagnostic test. You do diagnostic tests when the index of suspicion of the illness is high. Then, otherwise, you don't test. If you have an index of suspicion that is moderate, you tell people to stay home. That's it. It's awful that people get sick. I mean, I know. I got H1N1. It sucked. I treated people with it. It was awful. And we have another awful virus circulating around now. And by the way, if you combine corona and influenza this year, it's still just a moderate flu season. It's not even a severe flu season. Wow. So all these horror stories about lack of ventilators and hospital beds being full, that is total BS. Total BS. Do not be alarmed by the word pandemic, which the CNN reporters seem to have discovered this morning. Let me translate for you the word pandemic. Pandemic is a technical term that means A, a new virus, B, widespread. Do you think we have that? Yes, we do. Can you name for me the last pandemic? Well, we had one about 10 years ago, the H1N1. And, oh, my God, did the world come to an end then? I actually got H1N1. It was brutal. I don't like the fact that people have to get sick. But we are biological beings, and we have these viral outbreaks, and we're in one now. We don't have treatment. We don't have vaccines yet, though we will. In the meantime, we have containment, and contain it we will. period. Wash your hands, get your flu shot. That should be the story. Wash your hands, get your flu shot. Every sentence should end with that, because you are way orders of magnitude more likely to die of the flu than the coronavirus. We have 18,000 dead from the flu, 280,000 hospitalized so far in this country. We have 26 dead from coronavirus. Which should you be more concerned about? Tell me that. Just do the math. If you are over the age of 70, maybe over the age of 65, particularly if you have any chronic medical conditions, and if you are a smoker over 50, you should be behaving differently than the rest of us. You should be essentially staying home for a while. You shouldn't be going to public events. You should do some social distancing for a couple of weeks until this thing blows over, and that's it. The rest of us, go about your business. I'm traveling all over the country this week, and the planes are full. The airports are full. People are wearing masks foolishly. Why is anybody listening to anybody else? This is a medical problem. Did you hop into the H1N1 epidemic? Were you guys all involved with that? Were you criticizing the CDC and the government during the H1N1 epidemic? That one was worse.
Yeah.
And, but where were you guys? We couldn't have done it without you. Oh, wait a minute. It's fine. You don't even remember it. Listen, the story should be the World Health Organization and the CDC and the equivalent agencies in the various countries across the world should be taking a bow. We should be tipping our hat to them for doing an extraordinary job.
So who's this Ayala chick that I just read her tweet from? Well, she's in a, I guess she used to be a porn star and quit. So here's her about page. Interesting woman. We read from her about page. During a truth or dare game, someone asked me what my most proud accomplishment was, and I cited number one Gone Wild post of all time, which is weird because I put a fraction of the skill and effort into that than I have into other things, which means I just feel pride when lots of people like me. Okay, so, wow. Okay, here she is. So it's a thread on Reddit, I guess. So here, I'll just, there she is. Interesting check. Okay, about says, I was homeschooled from birth at the end of high school by professionally evangelical fundamentalist Christians in Idaho. After leaving home, losing my faith, got a blog post here on faith, getting kicked out of college for being too poor, I turned to a series of shitty jobs involving windowless factories and waking up at 4 a.m. I eventually escaped from that into the warm, wet embrace of porn, which I used to fund dives into faraway realms, both physical and psychedelic. I did a documentary or two. I spent a year developing a serious acid habit. Eventually, I quit porn and being the universe to do the next logical step, a crypto ICO in Korea. Now I'm comfortably settled in San Francisco, having co-founded my own damn company. So now you can buy a deck of difficult questions to persecute strangers and loved ones alike. My hobbies include ballroom dancing, fantasy sci-fi, and world building, rationality of the less wrong variety, cartography, circling, traffic intersections, sweating on command, playing TF2, abalone, and the accordion, painting, typing super fast, and sloppily debating consciousness in dimly lit group houses. Contact me on Twitter or by imagining an idealized version of me. If you'd like to support me, I accept little bits of money to fund my Soylent habit. Oh, this is great. Let's watch the trailer here. I hope it's not too nasty.
Can I tell you a secret?
Whoops, sounds pretty nasty.
I liked the idea of everybody watching me.
You gonna see some boobies.
I was nervous at first, but it's been more than I could have imagined.
Quiet.
Shh. It's kind of like having a TV show. You're distant, but you're close to people at the same time.
Thank you.
Why don't you tell me, Sarah? Tell me.
You're doing it in the setting of your own bedroom. It's very intimate. You're sharing personal details.
Tell me that you really.
There's no script.
It's fuzzy.
I'm the person that's asking them how their day was. Part therapist, part sex object.
Tell me that you're praying for me.
Was that the most awesome thing you've seen tonight?
I get excited about just being able to show someone an inviting, sexual, and funny time with a girl that otherwise they don't know how to approach.
Let's have a good time. What can I do for you?
Sensual, hi.
Oh my God. When you think cam girls, you think essentially just porn as it happens. But camming is very much the emotional connection, not necessarily just the physical.
Hi. Nice to see you.
There's somebody for everybody's taste.
Thank you. Why don't you tell me, Sarah? Tell me.
Camming is freedom.
It's changed my life completely.
Tell me that you really love me.
Aw, you're amazing.
Why don't you tell me, Sarah?
It's like the law of attraction, giving and receiving. It's a form of connecting.
Tell me that you're praying for me.
Okay, that's Cam Girls. Okay, she's also in a Netflix show, Unplanned America.
This is Unplanned America, where you're invited to join Parv, Nick, and me, Gonzo, as we flee Australia to road trip around the land of the free in search of the weird, wonderful, mysterious, and sometimes scary unplanned side of America.
I came here, I burnt my fucking car within like 2 weeks of being here.
That's just a symbolic way of looking at freedom, you know, separating yourself from a personal possession.
The majority of them are social misfits.
Did you know that there is energy tubes up here to take you to a different universe?
Some are hiding from warrants in other states.
I liken racism to me not liking your fucking socks, now I fucking hate you.
And they come out here just for solitude.
In the spectrum of weird shit that goes on in the fetish world, this would probably be less common.
I guess this is her.
Unless you've experienced it, is almost something that can't even be described in words. It's starting to get really intense because there's $50,000 on the line.
Criminals have guns, so we carry guns. Now, the militia is just an extension of that.
In 2007, I come back home and I was lost. Just lost.
You know, you go online and then you have a whole bunch of people watch you and they can chat in exchange for tips.
I guess that's her.
I'm unfortunately still basically estranged from my mom and my sisters. I'm not welcome home at Christmas and things like that with my mom's side. It just stinks when someone puts conditions on their love for you. I think that's really tough.
We're on our way to buy cannabis edibles for the shamanistic ceremony that we're about to go through tonight.
Here goes everything.
Everybody goes on different themes, but the shamans are guiding the entirety of the ceremony.
All I could focus on was this, like, fucking fear that something horrible and terrible was going to happen.
So join Parv, Nick, and me, Gonzo, as we journey across the vast and varied United States, diving headfirst into the unplanned side of America.
Think this happens overnight. She was so mistaken.
Okay, so just reading some more tweets from this Ayala chick. She writes, I'm open to repressed memories of childhood sexual trauma being a thing, but I'm genuinely curious how they know the memories aren't dreams. I've had lots of childhood memories I thought definitely happened, but turned out to probably have come from dreams. As in, the felt sense of an extremely faint memory feels identical to me to the sense of a very old dream. I literally cannot distinguish the two without outside help or corresponding markers from other more concrete memories. Google is giving me all the numbers except the one I want about how fast is coronavirus multiplying, as in if a community has 100 cases on day one, how many will it have on day two? I use shopping as emotional comfort, like eating junk food. It's unhealthy in excess, but I've recently been redirecting myself into the granola of shopping, cheap jewelry. Jewelry is small, so no storage problems and a wide variety. A lot of what draws me to shopping is the experience of browsing things and making a selection, using the selected objects as sort of peacock display. Jewelry fits this perfectly with far fewer downsides than regular clothes shopping. She tweets, I'm getting on cam in a few minutes, planning on keeping most of my clothes on, but we can sing or talk about weird opinions, or maybe I'll break out some old mime, who knows. She tweets, I believe COVID is bad and real, but a tiny part of my brain is like, nah, it's not real, it's fake like a movie. And I'm like, WTF brain, don't you see these horrific frontline videos? And my brain is like, nah, germs are probably fake too. Hand washing is just superstition. I honestly feel like a small part of my brain does not believe in germs, bacteria, viruses, or anything small. Thinks all the science and microphotography are just good world building like Lord of the Rings, but is ultimately a cute fantasy. Some parts of my brain are retarded. This has to be the most intelligent cam girl ever. The two most depressingly idiotic discourses I consistently see are those on abortion from both sides, nearly everything said online about Amazon's tax burden. Can we please have laws against incorrect music usage? The human race evolved out of sludge, harnessed nature to invent incredible technology to make the sickest beats. And we go and copy and paste those sick beats onto time lapses of eggs rotting. One thing that me and socialists have in common, I presume, is that government bailouts for corporations seem like a really terrible idea. Wow, this girl is lively. I like her. Knowingless.com is her website. Right, let's get back. Let's get sober here, guys. Let's talk about the power of habit.
So, backing your car out of your driveway, the first couple of times you did it, it took this major dose of concentration, right? It's actually a very complicated thing because you have to do spatial calculations, look in mirrors, reversed images. But when you back your car out of your driveway now, you just do it. You don't even have to think about it, right? You can think about the meeting you have later that day or realize that you left your kid's lunch on the counter. That's a habit. And the story I really want to tell you today is about this product named Febreze. Does anyone use Febreze? Okay, a couple of people use Febreze. To tell you about this product, which is one of the...
Okay, I don't want to hear about that. Let's go back to Dr. Drew. What is Dr. Drew saying?
We have a new illness. We identified it. We know the epidemiology. We created a test for it. We don't yet have a vaccine and a treatment, but it's underway. In the meantime, we are containing it. They should take a bow. We should be tipping our hat to them. Could things have been done faster? Always. Always. That's the way medicine is. We contemplate, we think, we try to do no harm before we jump in. This is like saying the surgeon took too long to do the operation. The surgery worked out great, but I wish he'd been, you know, not spent those last 2 hours thinking about the risk and benefits of that surgery. This is insanity. This is a level of insanity that has me angry. This
That's
is not,
a great point.
The medical profession is fine with it. We have a little bit faster, would have been good. A little more private sector involvement would have been good. Yeah.
Yep. In a few weeks, this is going to phase out. Is that just because there is a flu season and you expect the COVID-19 to sort of follow the same timeline as your typical flu season?
I don't expect it. I guarantee it. Viruses have a life. They come on, they grow, they plateau, and they go away. There's a time course to the life cycle of every influenza, every viral outbreak. And we are in the uptick right now. We are about to hit the plateau. We will contain, and then it will start to die out. It hates heat, it hates humidity, and it will go away. If this gets into the homeless population, well, if the government would like to spend some of that $8 billion, why don't they go and take care of the most vulnerable population we have in the country, which are people who are immunocompromised?
So I'm told that this really smart Twitter girl is named Rachel Slick, cam girl. So... Here's a video of her.
Oh, off. Okay, good. Hello, and welcome to a debate show without an interesting name. This is our premiere episode, at least on the re-release here with Atheist Analysis. And Joining us, we have Rachel Slick and Sean, a.k.a. Venom Fang X, and he's kind of just getting loaded up here. So we are here to talk about, I believe the topic is whether or not their beliefs have an objective basis. So we'll see how cool that is and how that goes. Sean, are you here?
Yeah, I'm here. I don't know if my mic is working.
Your mic is working. Your video is not working.
All right. Let me see if I can get my video working.
Okay, cool.
Come on, guys.
While he's working on that, if you have any questions at all.
So she's a daughter of a Christian pastor.
And I believe that goes good.
Sorry, I didn't realize I was muted for a second. Sean, do you want to go ahead and give your opening argument, and then we'll let Rachel do it, and then we can...
Yeah, sure. I prepared an opening statement, and I think the format of this discussion would be a 5-minute opening and then followed by an informal discussion. Is that still the case?
That is correct, yeah.
Okay, wonderful. So I'll begin my opening statements. All right, so the purpose of why I prepared an opening statement was just to make clear exactly what my position is, and I'm hoping to address...
open to having your mind changed on the matter. If this is true, and please correct me if I'm wrong, could you explain why this is the case? And my second point relates to the topic of objective truth. The Christian standpoint is that objective truth exists and that its foundation, creator, or nature, depending on how you define it, and please feel free to clarify those definitions, is God. Now, this is something we have to explore in a great deal more depth. When I was a Christian, there were some indications in physics and in my own personal intuition that nothing exists unless it is observed. And I took this as an implication that God was the ultimate observer, that he was the provider of a consistent reality.
So her father is Matt Slick, who was parodied on The Daily Show.
Look at these clips from The Daily Show on Comedy Central.
Christians are getting bullied. The Christians that I talk to are intimidated. They'll often get persecuted.
For what?
For just saying that they believe that homosexuality is wrong or that homosexuals are sinful, just like adulterers, just like pedophiles, just like liars, just like thieves. I'm just informing them.
Okay, so the homosexuals don't like that.
Mm-hmm. That's right. They're not very tolerant.
So, hey, jerks, be more tolerant of your intolerance.
On the next broadcast on the Line of Fire, we're going to tell you what really happened and how a Christian leader was lied to and how those clips were edited to make him look bad. Join us for the next broadcast, 2 to 3 p.m.
Okay, that's Matt Slick, I guess, on the Daily Show. And then this is his daughter, Rachel Slick.
This meant that there was an objective truth and that God was it. But I think that here the crux lies on our definitions of objective and subjective. I would define objective as according to, I think, dictionary.com, I got it from one of those sites, as being the object or perception of thought belonging to the object of thought rather than to the thinking subject, as opposed to subjective, with a subjective definition being existing in the mind.
So here is her story. She writes, I was born in 1992. My parents named me Rachel after the biblical wife Jacob loved. One of my earliest memories is of my dad's gigantic old Bible. Its pages were falling out, its margins were scrawled over with notes, and the leather cover was unraveled in places from being so worn out. Every night after we stacked up the dishes after our family dinner, he would bring it down and read a passage. I was always requesting something from the book of Revelations or Genesis because that's where most of the interesting stories happened. After he was done, he'd close the Bible with a big whoomp and turn to me. Now, Rachel, he would ask, what is the hypostatic union? And I would pipe back, the two natures of Jesus. What is pneumatology? The study of the Holy Spirit. What is the communicatio idiomatum? The communication of the properties in which the attributes of the two natures are ascribed to the single person. Occasionally, he would go to speak at churches about the value of apologetics, and the times I went along, he would call on me from the crowd and have me recite the answers to questions about theology. After I sat down, he would say, my daughter knows more about theology than you do. You are not doing your jobs as Christians to stay educated and sharp in the faith. Conversation with him was a daily challenge. He would frequently make blatantly false statements such as purple dogs exist, force me to disprove him through debate. He'd respond to things I said demanding technical accuracy so that I had to narrow my definitions and my terms to give him the correct response. It was mind-twisting, but it encouraged extreme clarity of thought, critical thinking, and concise use of language. I remember all this beginning around age 5. I have 2 sisters, 3 and 7 years younger than myself. We were all homeschooled in a highly strict, regulated environment. Our A. Becker school books taught the danger of evolution. Our friends were good influences on us, fellow homeschoolers whose mothers thought alike. Obedience was paramount. We did not respond immediately to being called. We were spanked 10 to 15 times with a strip of leather cut from the stuff they used to make shoe soles. Bad attitudes, lying, or slow obedience usually warranted the same. The slogan was, all the way, right away, and with a happy spirit. We were extremely well-behaved children. My dad would sometimes show us off to people he met in public by issuing commands that we automatically rushed to obey. Training was not just external. God commanded that our feelings and thoughts be pure, and this resulted in high self-discipline. Recently came across this entry in a workbook I wrote when I was 9. I'm hopeless. Oh boy, I've got a lot to work on. I try to be obedient, but it's so hard. The more I read, the more I realize how bad I am. My problem is that when things don't make sense to me, I don't like them. When Dad gets mad at me for something, everything makes perfect sense to me in my mind, so I tend to resent my parents' correction. I've just realized that I yearn to please the Lord, but why can't I? I just can't be good. It seems impossible. Why can't I be perfect? Wow, this is interesting girl.
Belonging to the thinking subject rather than to the object of thought, as opposed to objective. So to an extent, operating under the Christian worldview, there is an objective truth as it exists in comparison to us. It exists if you believe God exists and that his view is what creates ours.
Okay, here she is on the Age of Reason, Rachel Slick's journey to atheism. Sounds...
Welcome to the first episode of The Age of Reason. I am your host, the neo-atheist, Mike Phelps. Jason couldn't be with me tonight. Something came up. And we're just going to have to drive on without my partner in crime tonight. Well, it's always a pleasure. Well, it's always a pleasure, Rachel. Thank you for being here tonight and being the subject of discussion.
Yeah, I'm surprised people are still interested. I posted an article. There was like a problem with the Bible that I couldn't answer at the time, and it just kind of like flipped my worldview over enough to like let everything cascade into place. And I posted about it when my dad's video came out of him on The Daily Show. There were a post on Reddit about it, and so I posted there. I don't remember what I said. Some sort of comment like, yeah, it's my dad, and he, you know, really believes some of this stuff. And then I got an email from, how do you say his name out loud? Hemant? I feel kind of retarded. Okay.
Hemant.
He sent me a message being like, would you like to write an article about your story for Patheos? And I was like, yes. And so I wrote it, and I wish I had proofread it or like made a couple drafts, because I didn't think it was going to be a big deal. I just wrote it really fast, submitted it, and then it blew up a lot.
Well, the article itself, it did blow up right after it came out, but one of the things that I found inspirational about it was just your personal journey. You could tell that you actually put a part of yourself into the article, and it was a great representation of the personal journey in which you went through. I mean, mm-hmm. It actually made me relate to you at a personal level, because anyone that's actually read the article, that I've talked to at least, they basically can relate to the being in a religious household and how that actually affects them at the personal level. And that's something that you captured at the essence of your article itself, which I want to commend you on, and a lot of the people I talked to would probably say the exact same thing.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Yeah, I try really hard to, I think it's very important to convey vulnerability when conveying any sort of topic, because, you know, you have to be able to give a part of yourself in order to let people understand.
Well, let's actually dive into that. Now, one of my first questions is actually going to be this. Now, what weaknesses in your faith did you actually find at times? What questions did you have growing up in religion that sort of made you question it at the core dynamic of it?
Well, I mean, I guess weakness is relative. I doubted constantly while growing up, you know, as I think most people who think do. The only difference was that I had somebody who sounded very confident present to answer all my questions in a very intelligent sounding manner. So, I mean, I guess you could say a weakness was doubting, but growing up I didn't believe, and the people I talked to said, like, doubting is good. Like, you're supposed to deepen your faith and grow it. And I think even from the atheist perspective, it wouldn't have been a weakness in the fact that it led to a strengthening of the faith. When I had a question, it didn't make me be like, maybe this is all fake. I said, maybe this is all fake, but here's why it's not. And then it just became a more powerful argument against atheists.
Now, when did you actually, at what age did you actually figure out that, wow, I don't really believe this, and I may be a secular-minded individual?
18 was when I lost my faith. But it took quite a bit longer to stop thinking like a religious person in regards to like self-policing, you know, thoughts and behaviors, because a lot of religion is focused on like thinking pure thoughts and being exposed only to pure sort of media and input. So even after I stopped with the mental thing, a lot of my being was ingrained into that mindset. So I guess it really depends on how you you define the secular mindset?
Well, with that actually being said, now, when you turned 18 and you actually realized you're an atheist, what was the response from your family? Was there supportive members in your family? Was it a, wow, she's going against God? What was the mindset of the household in your family at the time when you realized you're not religious?
They don't really talk to me about it that much, actually. When I posted about it on Facebook, was I didn't tell them directly. And I think my mom doesn't like to talk about it, so I think her response was, I suspect it was a lot of grief, because from her eyes, you know, I'm going to hell now, I've rejected God, and like the daughter that she loves so dearly is going to suffer for all eternity. I mean, that's probably a really horrible thing for any mother to go through. So, I mean, I feel kind of bad about that. But she didn't really say too much to me, because I tend to have responses to things, I think, very intellectually, and she tends to operate more on a feeling-based way, and my sisters just, you know, they didn't get it at all. They're like, why? And the explanations didn't work. But yeah, and I haven't spoken to my dad for quite some time, so I don't know how he responded.
Well, that's actually something that is understandable. I mean, when something like that happens that rocks the foundation of somebody's belief system, and it's bound to have a backlash within a family household. And mm-hmm. not being able to come to grips with the situation is something, it's easier to sweep it under the rug than actually deal with the situation head on.
Well, I mean, from a family, like, how exactly are you going to deal with a member of your family leaving the faith? Like, what does dealing with it entail?
I can say for my family, people are disowned.
I would argue that's not really a good way to deal with it. I mean, ideally. Like, how would we want a religious family to approach that?
Well, that's actually a very good question. And a lot of families deal with it in different ways. I mean, me and Wesley actually have something in common there. I've got a Tea Party uncle that basically disowned me the second he found out I'm an atheist. It's made some situations in my own personal life with my family. I mean, this guy is so much of a teabagger. He was actually at Glenn Beck's Million Man March at Washington. He was basically one of those guys in the front row that had a sign.
Yeah, bizarre story.
And just that I have somebody like that in my family is something that I have to chuckle about, because, I mean, as much of an activist as I am in the atheist community, I've got somebody that is basically the complete 180 to that on the religious side of the fence that was the previous generation before me.
That's great. The contrast, I mean, the disowning probably isn't that great. But...
yeah, but the contrast is something.
Okay, I guess Milo went on Alex Jones.
Yeah, bizarre stereotypical music here. We got Milo Yiannopoulos here of Censored.tv with the great work with Gab McGinnis. And he's with us here on air. Did a great job. I watched it last night. I didn't watch it live with Owen Schroyer. Wow, good to have you here in Austin. Glad you came to visit. Got a new big book about to come out. Mm-hmm. But just first and foremost, what's front and center for you?
Well, good to see you. Thanks for having me back. I've been spending the last couple of weeks trying to avoid this hysteria about coronavirus and all of the, you know, it's not entirely clear to me that it even exists. You walk out in the street in New York and Austin, everything seems completely fine. But what I have noticed are all these command and control precedents being set up. You know, if you can, they just closed down hockey just now, a few minutes ago, the NBA yesterday, you know, you can shut these games down for something else.
I was just talking to one of the crew here who has family in Mexico, in Monterey, they're just closing school. No one knows that yet. We're about to write an article on it.
The distressing thing about it for lovers of individual liberty is that this is clearly a precedent setting, right? If you can close down the NBA for this, then you can do it more easily in the future.
And any group wants to shut down the world economy, they just release a novel virus, it's all over.
Every 2 to 4 years in time of the elections, just peculiar that, you know, the Democrats.
So who do you think the prime suspect is for this?
Well, Democrats got the recession they wanted, the recession that's the only possible thing that could get Donald Trump out of office.
And they're openly celebrating it. That should end their party forever.
They can't get the guy out of office with a candidate. They can't get him out of office on the facts. They can't get him out of office on the merits. It seems to me the only thing they can get him out of office with is a recession. So that's what they're trying now.
So headline, Milo Yiannopoulos, Democrats bet everything on coronavirus.
Of course. I mean, it's the best thing that's ever happened.
Or Democrats love corona. So I love New York. I love corona.
Listen, I've no doubt there is some kind of flu. I mean, coronavirus has been on the back of bottles of antiseptic or whatever for 3 years already. It has existed for a while, you know. But the clearly the hysteria is manufactured, and clearly it is serving one particular side of the political aisle who are going in ham on it.
And a friend emails to me, if you ever meet a woman who claims to have recovered memories of molestation, she's radioactive level dangerous. Get the F away from her. She could accuse you next. This is the best article on the matter. Sends me to an article in The Guardian. Meredith Moran writes, did my father really abuse me? In the 1980s, Meredith Moran remembered her father abusing her. Years later, she wondered whether those memories were false. When I was in my 30s, I accused my father of molesting me. I didn't see him or talk to him for 8 years. I didn't let my children see him either, and then I realized it wasn't true. In the late 1970s, a handful of feminist scholars had done some groundbreaking research and delivered some distressing news. Incest wasn't the rare anomaly it had long been believed to be. It happened often in normal families. Psychological phenomenon called repressed memory had allowed this to go unacknowledged, even unknown. These findings transformed incest from a dirty secret of family life into an obsession. In the 1980s and early 1990s, several cultural icons, including Roseanne Barr and Oprah Winfrey, went public as incest survivors. Incest memoirs hit bestseller lists. The Color Purple, a novel about incest, won the Pulitzer Prize. Meanwhile, children were being removed from their homes and parents were being sent to jail. Thousands of families were torn apart by accusations of sexual abuse, often made by adult daughters who claimed to have repressed, then recovered memories of childhood molestation by their fathers. Mine was one of them. In 1982, when I was a writer and mother of two young children, I got a job editing a book by one of those pioneering feminist researchers. I was shocked and moved by what I learned. With missionary zeal, I spent the next few years writing exposés of child sexual abuse for newspapers and magazines. The more I learned, the more I felt I joined a backroom club. I found it all endlessly compelling. The newest incest study, the latest theory, the most promising new treatment. Conversations with my husband and friends seemed trivial in comparison. One evening, I was at a therapy group researching an article, and as I sat listening to one of the accused men speaking, I heard a voice in my head. It was my father. I was 15. He was yelling at my first boyfriend, Carl, saying, "She's mine. I'll kill you if you don't leave her alone." And then I saw Carl yelling the same thing. Which version was real? Who was the violent one? Was I making this whole thing up? Why did I leave home at 17? When I was a little girl, my dad was my best friend and I was his. We had everything in common, including we liked each other more than either of us liked my mother. But as a teenager, I lost my interest in him. I'd met Carl and I'd been forbidden to see Carl. Just like that, my hero became my enemy. My parents divorced, my father remarried twice. When I got home from group that night, I couldn't stop crying. My husband put his arms around me. And for the first time in 10 years of marriage, my body involuntarily recoiled from his touch. I cried myself to sleep on the couch. I started having dreams about incest, about my father. How could I tell whether they were based on memories? Saw a series of therapists and my marriage fell apart. And then she became convinced that her father had molested her. She cut him off for 8 years. By 1990, I'd been following the instructions in The Courage to Heal for 2 years. I'd cut off all contact with my father, kept my children away from him. Then I realized I needed to stop writing and reading about incest, to stop all the therapy, spend time with old friends again, go out for drinks and to films that made me laugh instead of cry. By this point, there were dozens of satanic ritual abuse cases reaching the courts, but there was also a backlash growing led by the False Memory Syndrome Foundation. The same newspapers and TV shows that had covered the incest stories were jumping on the bandwagon. Therapists were sued for implanting false memories, stripped of their licenses in order to pay settlements. Convictions were overturned, the accused set free. I started to doubt myself. My father had a heart attack. I considered showing up on his doorstep. I sent a card. He replied saying he was ready to see me. And she said, when you first accused me, this is the father to the daughter here, I thought you'd come to your senses in a few days, but then I kept calling you and you wouldn't talk to me. I called your mother too. I asked her if there could be any truth to what you're saying. You know how it is, he said. You hear something often enough, you start to believe it is true. And this is her book, is entitled My Lie, A True Story of False Memory. Pretty disturbing.
For electoral reasons, clearly that's the Democrats. Clearly the media and the Democrats have a vested interest in the country shutting down ahead of the next presidential election. It's obvious, isn't it?
You know, they pulled that up. It's been on bottles of stuff for years.
Yeah. Because it's as far as I can tell.
Okay, I'm not going to play that. I think that's nonsense, but here's a virologist.
Hey, everybody, Dr. Zubin Nemanja. I have a super special guest today in the era of COVID hysteria. This is one of the leading experts on vaccine science, infectious disease, and general rational thinking. Dr. Paul Offit is a professor of pediatrics in the Division of Infectious Diseases at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. He is a tireless advocate for science, vaccines, and children's health. And he joins me today to talk about many things, in particular, how are we responding to this COVID-19 epidemic? And is our response like an over-exuberant immune system part of more damaging than the disease itself? Paul, welcome back to the show, brother.
Thank you.
Man, it's good to see you and hear your voice. Are you on lockdown over there? Because we're on lockdown here in the Bay Area.
Yes, lockdown. I mean, restaurants are closed, bars are closed, cafes are closed. The hospital has only essential personnel. So if you're not on service, don't come in. It's lockdown.
Man, and so how are you and your family sort of dealing with the lockdown? Because I've got my kids in the other room doing homeschooling, basically. My wife is going back and forth to Stanford or working from home because she's doing radiology and they're seeing cases. And so what are you guys doing to kind of weather this?
Well, first of all, our kids are adults, so they're no longer in the home. So it's just me and my wife spending a lot of time together.
And just so nobody under 16 has died from this pandemic, and virtually everyone who has died has had comorbidities. So it seems to particularly affect people who are fat, people with high blood pressure, people who have AIDS, people who have all sorts of other health problems. So maybe people who are reasonably healthy should be out and about. I don't know. I don't have a strong opinion on this. So I'm not taking any position.
They're trying to avoid, any sort of domestic abuse situation. So I think we're good.
It is a real, people, and again, this is actually getting to the heart of what we're going to discuss. People actually are underestimating the social, psychological, and physical ramifications of what we're doing. Can you sort of tell me what your thinking is on this?
No, I couldn't agree more. I mean, we have a virus that's come into this country that no one's seen before. So the entire population is susceptible. There's not a vaccine that can create immunity. So everyone's susceptible.
So I need to correct myself. A French girl who's 16, who is said to have no comorbidities, becomes the youngest person in Europe to die from the coronavirus. French girl, 16, with no underlying medical conditions. Right.
And it has the capacity to spread and do harm. And the question is how best to prevent that. We've taken draconian measures, and maybe that's what it took. But I would argue that we will look back on this situation and that we will see that there are districts or regions or countries that didn't do it exactly the way that we did it, that still had the capacity to prevent spread in a significant way. I mean, do we really need to close schools? Do we really need to close all businesses? I mean, wouldn't it make sense, for example, that if a child comes into a classroom and has this infection, that we close that classroom down for a day or two while we scrub everything down and then let people come back into the school again? I mean, which is pretty much what the CDC actually has recommended. Couldn't you do then the same thing with businesses? The other thing, just one point, is that this is a virus that primarily is going to kill people who are older and also have comorbidities, chronic lung disease, chronic heart disease, hypertension, et cetera. So you know who really the group is that's going to die. So that group then should stay home. Just weather this out for the next few weeks or a couple months or whatever it takes. Those people should stay home. I think anybody who has a mild respiratory illness or moderate respiratory illness should stay home. And the family that's in contact with them should stay home. Do that. And then obviously anybody who is older should limit any contact that they have with crowds and just do more sensible things. I just feel like by doing what we're doing, there will be a lot of unanticipated consequences, which could be dire. I mean, I think businesses will likely close down. I think people will lose jobs. People could become homeless. There'll be a ripple effect to this that will be very damaging. Right now, we have roughly 75 or so deaths in the United States, somewhere in that range. No, I'm sorry, it's 87 deaths. As of today, which is March 17th, I think it's 87 deaths, which is obviously any death is bad, but keep in mind the fact that the CDC estimates that as of March 7th, we've had between 22 and 52,000 deaths from influenza. And there are thousands of children who've died of respiratory syncytial virus in this country. So, which is not to say if you can't prevent it, but I just wonder at what cost we're ultimately preventing this.
Yeah, and I think, so there's a lot to talk about here, and I think you kind of stirred the pot a little bit on Facebook by making a post that sort of spelled some of this out, and it got my attention because it said a lot of the things that I have been trying to weave into what I've been saying in terms of the messaging on this, and it's this.
Okay, here is Stephen Colbert mocking Mnuchin's neurological damage on The Daily Show.
We get so obsessed with the big stories of the day that the little stories can fall through the cracks. Well, I love to get my hand down into that crack and see what I can fish out. In our beloved segment, Meanwhile. Meanwhile, yesterday I told you all about Donald Trump holding that press conference backed up by the cast of Reservoir Dorks. But take a look at Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin behind Trump while he's speaking. What is it? What is it that he's doing? Is he going to hock a loogie on Jared? Does he have a hairball? We don't know. Turns out there's a perfectly reasonable explanation once you turn down Trump and turn up Steve Mnuchin's audio. Jimmy, can we hear that, please?
Nobody knew a thing like this could have happened. When Justice, now Justice Gorsuch, got appointed, it was rough, but it was nothing. I didn't like doing for this man and what they're coming up with. And in many cases, fabricated, because as you know, many stories were pulled back.
Meanwhile, in astronomy news, a skull-shaped asteroid.
Okay, let's get back to this interview.
The damage that we can cause from our response to something that is a bit unknown, it can be more exuberant than the disease itself. Now, we'll talk about comparisons to influenza and RSV. We can talk about those things. We can talk about the overwhelm of the healthcare system. We can talk about the effectiveness of social distancing and the draconian measures. We can look at other countries and we can have that discussion, and we will. But I think in the short run, we need to think about what's driving the fear and the panic here, which is so harmful. Everywhere you look on the news, it's coronavirus. And everywhere, you know, they've canceled sports, they've canceled events. And some of that's very appropriate. But the thing is, it's creating a sense of anxiety and panic that is starting to breed real problems. Yesterday, when I went to the grocery store, because suddenly they announced we're on lockdown, it was pretty chaotic. If you want to create a scene where people are getting infected, suddenly announce a lockdown and have a run on the grocery stores where everyone's bumping into each other for eggs. So these kind of things have untoward consequences as well. Now, the rational approach of let's focus on people most at risk, let's have targeted measures. Again, we have no precedent really for how to make this unfold. And we can look at other countries, what Singapore and Korea are doing. But one of the things you mentioned in your post that I thought, and again, it was interesting because you're a bastion of science, reason, and a rational approach to the world. You've done it. You've talked about it in your books. You've talked about it with your work on vaccines. The response to your post was an exuberant, oh my God, you're not panicking enough, Paul. Like, what are you doing? You're causing harm here. And it's because you said things like, the reason we fear this virus, there's three good reasons to fear, generate true emotional fear around a virus. One is it kills children preferentially. This one doesn't. Another is it causes disfiguring permanent harm. With the exception of scarring of lung disease in patients at high risk, this one doesn't. The third is it kills the majority of people that it infects. Rabies is a good example. By the way, smallpox is a good example of disfiguring, right? And polio, a good example of affecting children, like really scary. And then killing a bunch of people, rabies. This one does none of those things. And yet we have upended the entire social and economic fabric of this country.
Okay, this interview was conducted March 17. I think I would rather, the president's about to speak. Meanwhile, let's go back to perhaps Rachel Slick here, speaking about her journey towards atheism.
Thing that has helped in those long, cold nights, what can I say? But yeah, let's get back to the topic at hand, though. I mean, now, we've actually outlined...
I just did what many other people have done. The only difference is I happened to have been somewhat more in the public eye, is all.
My administration,
what truth did you actually realize?
...to ensure that America has the medical resources and equipment needed to fight the global pandemic. It's been a brutal pandemic for over 150 countries all over the world. We've had great success over the last month.
When Trump reads remarks, you can just tell his heart's not in it. So not particularly interesting there. So let me go back to Rachel Slick, A Journey to Atheism.
After the situation, did you actually go through a mindset of where do I go from here? Or what was your mindset of where to proceed after this whole situation occurred?
I think the most terrifying thing about losing faith is the not knowing. Because I didn't understand that so many people operate under the comfort of saying, I don't know. And you know, it's a very fundamental part of science or study to be like, I'm developing this framework, but I don't know about this problem. Under Christianity, all questions had an answer and had to have an answer. And if you said, I don't know, to something, that meant it was implied that your position was fallible. And so transitioning from a completely strong framework where everything was known to an uncertain one was really bizarre. I had no idea how people operated like that. And you know, I had to figure out how to be comfortable with being like, I don't know. And it made me feel, I think, a more unintelligent in an ego sort of way. I feel like I had attached a great deal of personal pride to be able to have answers to questions. And so having to say, I have no idea, really humbled me quite a bit because like, I didn't know what was going on.
Now, you actually mentioned science. Your background, do you have a background in science?
Not beyond personal interest.
There's a lot of us that could actually say the same. Now, when it comes to actually the sciences itself, would you say that your personal knowledge and personal research that you did into the scientific fields played a role in your moving away from the religion?
Right. Yeah, I remember reading a couple books on like cosmology in the universe when I was like 14, 15, and up until that point, I believed in the young Earth. And then I read about the redshift and, you know, the expansion of the universe. I'm like, this doesn't fit. And so I started to argue against the young Earth theory. So, I mean, science did change, I wouldn't say a lot, but a good portion of my views as a Christian. I don't think science in general or the idea of the universe is what converted me out of Christianity, mainly because science doesn't have answers for things like, you know, the origin of the Big Bang, you know, the origin of life. And so, you know, as a Christian, it's a lot more appealing to have answers to those.
Well, I can understand that. Now, what can be done for individuals that are actually in that situation right now? And what advice would you actually give people that are basically having trouble dealing with a religious household? And what advice would you give them to help them through that?
Show love, I think, would be the primary thing. I mean, because you can argue all you want, but I think the vast majority of the time, somebody's belief is not rooted in the logicness of it or the internal consistency. The vast majority of the time, it's because it what meets some of their need on a really deep and primal level. And I think that on a primal level, everybody wants to be loved. And so if you're trying to witness to a Christian person, if you're trying to show them that Christianity is not the only answer, you have to show them that you can be an incredible person without having a set of moral laws that you have to follow. I think that's the most powerful witness anybody can have.
Okay, here's a Jewish commentary on rituals. Look.
Hey everybody, Zach again at newtutorial.com. Wanted to come in and do a video. It's Easter Day today. And so today is Easter Sunday, and I had to come out and make a video because I saw something that I thought was kind of interesting on one of my social feeds, and I wanted to share it with you and just make a point. Basically somebody was on Facebook saying basically because he lives, you know, he's risen today, right? You know, it's Easter.
Oh, okay, this guy's a Jew for Jesus, so let's get back to Rachel Slick here talking about her journey.
Very good. Go ahead.
I would tinker that just a tad and just say that you have to come at them at an emotional
sense, like, you know, you do good to others, and that seems to be like the basic thing, like just be nice and try and reduce harm in the world. But Christians just kind of take that and they like twist it a little bit, and so it makes your daily life so much more complicated, because instead of following yourself, you have to follow like these things, and then you have to go study how to follow these things. It's really interesting but difficult, very exhausting.
It's that whole compartmentalization. I mean, you got to keep on trying to tinker with that one side of your brain just to make everything fit.
Yeah. But yeah. I think people...
And having to reinforce it over and over.
People. It's just a personal choice I've made. And so when I left home, it was due to a swift realization of that like I wanted to live my life differently and in a different kind of environment. But I was still religious after that. It didn't really have to do with any religious reasons directly.
Now,
I'm just curious, quick question. How old were you when you actually moved out then?
17.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, what agendas or what advancement areas would you actually say are important for atheism as a movement, if you actually perceive atheism as a movement itself?
I have trouble seeing atheism as a specific movement, as something I want to advance, because it seems to be an important element of a larger framework. Atheism promotes a certain way of looking at the world, but there's so much more to life than simply not believing in God. And you cannot believe in God and have a very unfulfilling, unhappy life full of misery, you know? And so while I think atheism is done for good in the world, I have trouble advocating that specifically. Atheism should be, I think maybe one of the best things atheism could do would be to show how intertwined it is with a higher standard of living and how being an atheist improves a deeper... I just have buzzwords right now. Come on, I'm trying to say something meaningful. How atheism proves it, you know?
Now, going into that, what are your thoughts on confrontations with religious-minded individuals? How do you actually deal with a confrontational situation with somebody that is religious?
I don't think there really should... Well, what do you mean by confrontation? Having a disagreement?
Having a disagreement would be the core dynamic of that.
Okay, what's going on with Joe Biden? Let's have a look here.
Example, you know, I think there's more we're going to have to do as we go down the line here. But we're going for example, you know, additional checks to families should be required. But I think there's a minimum of. I won't go into all that. Let me just deal with your specific. You should have never been put in this position in the first place.
Okay, Joe Biden.
Okay, well, I mean, I enjoy debating people, and I think it's great to watch debates.
So apparently the guy on the far bottom right here, his nickname is Atheist Anal.
Because the intellectual pitting against each other is really a lot of fun. You know, as long as it stays to intellectual pitting, I think a lot of people can feel a great amount of anger towards the other side because, you know, they feel a sense of hurt. And both sides feel that. Both sides feel that the other side has wronged them. And so, I mean, when it comes to confrontation, I disagree heavily with any sort of confrontation motivated out of a sense of injustice. But when people confront me and be like, why aren't you Christian, I usually don't talk to them unless I feel like they're ready to listen, if that makes sense. So many people just want to proclaim, you know, and shout off of their soapbox, and there's nothing to be gained from that in talking to them unless you're conveying something that they don't already know. And you can say all of the rational arguments in the world, and they have responses for it. You just Google it, fucking karma comes up, and it's like, here's the standard response. Like, that's not what's going to get people to have any sort of change. Although it's fun. It is so much fun. And
you're preaching to the choir on that one, Rachel. I
yeah.
Fun, but there are times where you can actually get too much into it.
Initial part is figuring exactly what they believe. You know, that was satisfying. So you can continue just asking questions about it. And I mean, usually you don't get far with street preachers, but it's a lot of fun. I think I met one on the street recently, and I'm on Facebook, and he just goes off on these crazy rants. And it's really hilarious to watch. I mean, you have to know a person, really, before you can have any sort of meaningful conversation with them.
That actually is a great point. Now, when it comes down to leaders in the atheist community, who do you consider the ones that have inspired you, and why are they inspirational to you as a leader in the atheist community?
I'm not sure if it counts, but I really like Ayaan Hirsi Ali, if you're familiar with her.
It counts. It counts.
It does, yes.
I mean, she's more specifically working against, you know, the Muslim faith. But she's a really great inspiration, and she's an incredibly strong woman. Her story is amazing, and I'm a huge fan. She's incredibly intelligent, and she works with a great deal of compassion, I think.
Go ahead. But without?
Oh, but without, like, without compromising on what she believes. She'll tell the truth very, very firmly, but in love.
She was supposed to be part of the Four Horsemen with Dawkins, Hitchens, Dennett, Harris.
Supposed to be?
She was supposed to be, yeah. There was some sort of conflict or something, but like the whole documentary that they had, yeah, she was supposed to be a part of that group, and she would have been a lot more well-known now, which is a damn shame, because she is...
Okay, looking at an epidemiologist here on Twitter, Eric Fagel Ding. Herd immunity is a term used to achieve high vaccination rates. It is not an acceptable public health strategy to place people at risk of serious disease or death by exposing them to a novel virus. Stop it with the herd immunity, folks. That's an perspective of an epidemiologist.
One of the biggest opponents of, like...
Think about that. I get flustered bad when it comes to heroes. I don't know. I would probably try really hard to sound smart, and probably completely screw it up. I don't know how to ask.
What weaknesses in your faith did you actually have at the beginning of being religious? I mean, was there certain things that jumped out at you when you read the Bible that were like, wow, how could something like this really happen?
Well, it's a little odd because I feel like there's a mode in my head that's like the Christian mode, and I don't believe in Christianity. But whenever like I hear arguments against Christianity, I immediately switch into the Christian mode, and like I have this explanation that like I think of. I'm like, well, that's not a valid argument because of XYZ. And so when I read the Bible and there's something that a lot of people would be like, what is this? This makes sense. Like I switch into Christian mode. I'm like, that makes sense because of XYZ. I'm not sure if it's really objective, that sort of reasoning, or if it's just because I happen to have studied it a lot more than most people, so like I know why or like how it could be possibly explained away. There isn't very much about religion in regards to details that I find to be completely absurd. When people point out things like, you know, rape in the Bible, well, you know, in the Bible that was never really condoned. So, I mean, there are a lot of just little things like that, or like, you know, the crazy Leviticus laws. Well, I mean, there's the Mosaic Covenant, and I don't think that is an adequate explanation, but like it could be if you really wanted to believe it. So I think internally, religion, people have worked very hard at making religion make sense, and people have done a very good job at it because there's been many intelligent minds at this problem for many, many years.
I got a question.
Okay, let's get perspective saying recovery from this will be better than from the Spanish flu.
Ashish Jha, director of the Harvard Global Health Institute. Doctor, great to see you again. Thank you for being here. So, Dr. Birx, if I could just put it in a nutshell, saying that we've never collected as much data as we have for this particular pandemic because we have this great communication around the world that we didn't have for previous pandemics. That should inform us more than projections based on previous pandemics. What do you think?
Well, so Dr. Birx is, of course, right that we want to use as much real-life data as possible. I think what we ultimately want to get to is a combination. Those models tell us something about how diseases work. We know how diseases work. We know how they infect people. And then, of course, we've got to tie that in with real-life experience. So my feeling is we've got to put both of them together and really try to understand what it's teaching us, not one or the other, because they're both important.
But let me just give you an example. Yesterday, on a competing business network, the name of which I shall remain anonymous, they said that the COVID-19 outbreak could be deadlier than the 1917 Spanish flu. Now, that killed 50 million people. It doesn't seem like the death rate is going to be anywhere close to the Spanish flu, does it? I mean, not to do anything to diminish the importance or the severity of coronavirus, but I'm just saying, yeah, compared to the Spanish flu, I don't think we're going to hit those numbers. Do you?
I don't think we're going to hit 50 million around the world. I sure hope not, and I think there's good reason to believe we won't. Those are very scary numbers. Remember, 100 years ago, we didn't have the kind of healthcare system we have now. We didn't have the kind of data and prediction abilities that we have now. We didn't have treatments the way we are working on trying to develop. So I am cautiously optimistic. No one knows, of course, but that I don't think we're going to end up with the kind of numbers that we saw with the Spanish flu. But it's up to us. If we do a good job on managing this, we should be able to do much better than that.
Well, and frankly, we're already doing a much better job than a country like Italy, at least in terms of our mortality rate. Theirs is over 10% or close to it. Ours is about 1.5%.
Yeah, look, I want to caution everybody on mortality right now because we're early, right? So if you think about it, it's entirely possible, and I'm hopeful that we'll stay at 1.5%, maybe even go down as we do more testing. But we've got a lot of sick people in the hospital, and if a lot of them end up dying, then our mortality rate goes up. So I don't think there's any reason we should end up with the kind of numbers that we saw in Italy. But again, if we do a good job of, you know, getting people in, flattening that curve so that people aren't getting infected at very high rates, we should definitely be able to come in under where Italy is.
Well, let's talk about the availability of equipment right here in the United States, because we just saw the executive order come out. The president has used a presidential act to get GM to work and produce more ventilators. Do you think we'll have them in time? Right now, there's already a squeeze going on. It's going to take a couple of weeks to churn up these production lines to get the ventilators out. Will we have enough?
It's a great question. You know, I'm worried that in some places, New York is going to face a real crunch in the next couple of weeks. So I'm worried about whether New York is going to have enough. These production ramp-ups aren't going to be able to meet New York's needs. So we're going to have to come up with some other approach to get New York through this. But it's not just New York, right? Because I'm worried that in a week or 10 days, we're going to hit New Orleans is going to be in trouble. There'll be other cities, Atlanta. And so we just need a national strategy while we're ramping up to help these cities get through it, because city after city is going to be going through this over the next weeks and months.
And the health workers, I mean, you can't say enough. I think that they are the real heroes heroes, if there are any, in this whole situation. I mean, there are some regular men on the street, women on the street heroes as well. But you look at what the health care workers do day after day after day. Dr. Fauci said there may be a vaccine available for health workers in the fall. Do you know anything about that?
No, look, I know that there are a lot of people working on vaccines. There's about six different candidates, a couple in China, some here, Europe. I'm not aware that any of them will be ready for the fall. But Dr. Fauci's got his finger on the pulse better than I do. But my sense is that we're probably 9 to 12 months away. But it's possible that if we're making progress, we could try it out on health workers first. They really are the heroes.
Well, and I don't want to put words in his mouth, but I think what he was indicating is that there could be a way of fast-tracking, something that might not be a vaccine that might not be available or ready because of testing for the general population, because the need is so great by the healthcare workers, they could be essentially the ones to test it out.
That's entirely possible. And look, they are the highest risk. We need to protect healthcare workers. And so if we have...
Okay, let's get back to Rachel Slick here on her journey to atheism.
Question. You were just talking about switching into Christian mode there, and that just sounds like you were just so heavily indoctrinated as a child.
Esther, can you unmute yourself? Okay, well...
Maybe she went to pee.
She's there.
We're calling.
So, yes, let me see what next question I have in my itinerary tonight. This is actually a good one. What do you miss most about the good old days of religion?
The certainty. Well, uncertainty is nice. Certainty was so much nicer. It's really comforting. And
this live stream took place in 2015.
Relaxing to know everything. But also the community. I think a lot of the time we don't have the sort of, you know, base community. In Christian circles, you have a church, and if something goes wrong, like, the church takes care of you. People like make you meals if you have surgery. And they watch your kids. Like, this is an already established network of people who are very loyal to each other. And we don't...
I'm just thinking this is an advantage of being Jewish, because even in Orthodox Judaism, as long as you're not trying to spread atheism... Come on, man. Even if you're an atheist, it's not going to inhibit your ability to operate in Orthodox Judaism, to be welcomed in Orthodox Judaism, to be an essential part of the community in Orthodox Judaism, and it's a tight-knit community where people help each other. So in Christianity, belief is more important than behavior. In Judaism, what you do is more important than what you believe.
We don't have very much like that in the secular community.
Bring up community, that's actually a great venture into the next question. Now, were there any friends that you actually lost when you joined the secular community? Was there anyone that was like, wow, she's an atheist now, how can we even associate with her because she is not of the Holy Church?
Yes, actually, my best friend at the time, we were very close, but he was also a very large fan of my dad and Carm, and was very motivated for apologetics. And so when I left the faith and home, he just kind of, it fell apart between us because, you know, it was such an important thing to him, and I was now rejecting that. And so I lost my best friend over that, which kind of sucked.
Babylon B tweets, toilet paper crisis solved as government prints trillions of soft, fresh dollar bills. Poor Joseph Watson tweets, a top government official in France has admitted that draconian lockdown measures being imposed on the rest of the population shouldn't be implemented in the country's migrant-heavy ghettos to prevent riots.
And I keep in contact with only one person from... One friend from that life, and she's an atheist now, which is why I think we get along. But Christians are so insular. They have very little desire to interact with people who don't also go to church and talk about God. You know, I mean, from the Christian point of view, God is like the base, the bedrock of everything. And if you don't have God, like, everything is wishy-washy and you can't operate correctly. Why would you ever want to associate with somebody like that? And they won't say it, and they won't say it to each other outright, and they don't, and they probably don't think it directly, but it's absolutely present.
Okay, that's Rachel Slick. Let's go to Richard Spencer's live stream from a couple of years ago.
Sharing beers and pina coladas. Imagine that might be a good way to spread the virus. Imagine that. Okay. Martin Madrigal for three. Boomers can't make a sacrifice for their grandchildren when they don't have any grandchildren. Okay. I don't quite know what you're saying there. Boomers certainly do have grandchildren. Son of John for three. Richard, you seem to be pro-eugenics, but also dead set on outright quarantine for a virus that exclusively removes the sickly from the gene pool. I don't understand this contradiction. Yeah, you know, I'm not sure that I could, you know, just say, let's just leave this up to nature. I mean, there might very well be, when you take a step back, some eugenic aspects to coronavirus. It is attacking people who suffer from diabetes, people who are obese, people who are sickly, and so on. But this is, you know, you've got to separate a policy like that from dealing with an emergency. I mean, the clear primary first thing you've got to do with as a politician is protect the nation. And, you know, I think we should engage certainly in positive policies of promoting good breeding, you could say. That is taxing the hell out of people. I've joked about things like making contraception illegal if your IQ is above 115, things like that. I mean, taxing the hell out of spinsters and bachelors, particularly if they're highly intelligent. I mean, they're just things you could do eugenically that would be much more positive. And just, you know, I don't know, maybe nature has a way of doing this. But, you know, in terms of, you know, eugenics is a conscious policy. I mean, the kinds of things that occur with nature are not necessarily beneficial to greater intelligence and health and flourishing and beauty. You know.
Kelsey Piper tweets, one thing I've struggled with personally, I told my family in early February that we should expect the virus to hit here and we should buy what we need and plan to soon to stop leaving our home. Wasn't that direct in a public article for three more weeks? Why not? I didn't want to sound alarmist. I didn't want to step out ahead of public health officials who were still telling us that the risk was low. I wanted to tell readers what scientists were saying, and they, too, were trying not to sound alarmist. I don't want to imply I was silent. I argued that we shouldn't scold people who were worried about the coronavirus. I said we were underprepared for pandemics. I said there'd be a bad one someday, even if this one wasn't it. Early February, I said COVID-19 probably wouldn't kill tens of millions. And in late February, I issued a correction in Future Perfect's newsletter. It absolutely might kill tens of millions, despite getting some calls right pretty early. Talks about Professor Zeynep Tufekci, who wrote an op-ed for the New York Times and The Atlantic that I read on the show. Her criticisms here sound pretty true to me. And she wrote, we wasted February, and the failure wasn't just from the administration. Many in media, too, fueled the complacency. Why? Because we don't know how to think about complex systems, something we must learn to get through. I explain how. We desperately needed some institution that would seriously pursue the hypothesis our government was incompetent and wrong or lying. We desperately needed more skepticism brought to bear on every published procedure and number. I thought I was a cynic, and I was not cynical enough to guess the scope of the mistakes we were making here. Not in time to write anything that would have changed them. And I deeply regret not telling my readers sooner what I told my family. I have no idea if you would have believed me, but you deserve to know. And I wish that when the government dropped this ball, more people had been there to pick it up. And Matt Stoller comments, I was worried about this virus in January, but I didn't really start talking about it publicly for a few weeks because I was worried about being seen as an alarmist. It's embarrassing to say things publicly that sound crazy, even if you think that they are true.
Not only, it's not just the most intelligent and most sane and sensible and open-minded and thoughtful and empathetic survive. It can often be the opposite. So, yeah. Drake God 84, those numbers will increase, Richard. It's only because we're able to treat these people with hospital medicine as soon as the infection rate includes one half the nation, those numbers will easily increase to 10 to 15%. You're absolutely correct. I mean, you know, in a way, there's a kind of weird strategy of, you know, get corona early because the whole concept of flatten the curve is basically we don't want to overwhelm the system all at once. And we are already reaching something what seems like a breaking point, you know, with in places like New York City and so on. And yeah, it might actually be better to get in early and get the therapy you need. And, you know, once they're out of hospital beds or they're out of ventilators, you're SOL. Okay. The Mazda 202 for 50. Awesome. $50. Thank you. Keep up the good work and stay safe. I appreciate that. Thanks for the $50. I do appreciate it. One Man's Chorus for $5. Richard, if Costco and Kroger are having trouble keeping their shelves stocked to the current demand, imagine how much worse it would be if they gave everyone $1,000.
Okay, so National Guard on the streets. Remember when they said anyone claiming National Guard would end up policing people were conspiracy theorists? Well, seems to be happening. Rhode Island State Police and National Guard having passenger cars from New York City stop at this rest stop on I-95 North to register them as someone who needs to self-quarantine for 2 weeks if they stay in Rhode Island. That's interesting. Okay.
I think there's a kernel of truth in what you're saying. I admit that if that giving everyone $1,000 would have some direct price inflation of just basic consumer goods, but we are in a deflationary spiral. And yeah, toilet paper is sold out, but you know, no one is going to a movie theater. I don't think anyone is going.
We're in a deflationary spiral, so giving everyone $1,200 is not going to jumpstart inflation because we're in such a deflationary spiral. If we gave everyone $100,000, yeah, that would jumpstart inflation, not $1,200.
No one is going shopping. No one is doing all these basic things that have basically collapsed. I mean, Hollywood has gone to zero. I saw that, you know, for better and for worse, maybe for better. But yeah, basic aspects of the economy are going to zero. You know, your local coffee shop, your local whatever. And we just basically allow people, and that means that people who are working at these places are not receiving income. If we just keep these people alive, basically, and feeling like they're not losing their heads and going out and killing people in the streets or, you know, engaging in theft and mayhem, we could come out of this and be okay, and we could kind of start up again. So I don't think, I don't know. Yeah, you're right. I mean, of course you're right. When you give people direct money, like they might spend it in weird ways, but I would rather do this than the typical 2008, 2009 way of interest rates at zero, pumping credit, not cash, into the financial sector. And you know, that's no good.
Okay, what's going on with His Holiness the Pope? So the Pope walks alone in an empty Rome, the bells muted by the sound of ambulances. Okay. Thanks for watching, everybody. Appreciate it. Let's go out to Bridge Over Troubled Water.
Bye-bye.